There you have it, Jane's Addiction. Clap, clap, clap. Sympathy for the Devil. Sending that out to Sully in D.C. His Twitter is IrishDummy01. He's in traffic right now in the D.C. area, and he picked today's opening song. So there you go.
And I liked it.
There's a little Kennedy reference in there, and we had Robert F. Kennedy Jr. in here yesterday.
What was the reference? And they were like, I heard that pilot kid 1 minute.
We gotta let Mark in on this. We have to talk about it again. We just have to. Yesterday we have Robert F. Kennedy Jr. in here. We had a pretty good interview. He's got a book out, and he was really good. And then after the show, it's me, Jimmy.
It's a book about kitchen safety.
Jim Florentine and Theo Vaughn. We take a picture, and then he's talking about the JFK assassination.
Uh-huh.
And it's stuff he's talked about before, but we've never heard this. And we're in the company of a Kennedy discussing his uncle's assassination.
Right.
And he's like, the Bay of Pigs, CIA operatives, trained killers, and all this stuff.
Yeah.
The Warren Commission, why would that guy want because of this and that? He's kind of connecting all the dots for us. And we're sitting there, just none of us are talking. Jimmy's sort of leading him a little bit. But besides that, we're all just staring, going, holy fuck, this is a Kennedy talking about the JFK assassination. You're never going to get this moment again in your life.
And we had wrapped up the show, kind of. We had to come back and do plugs, but we were done.
Yeah.
We were done. I looked at Jimmy like, you want to end? He's like, why don't we come back and do the plugs? And at that point, the plugs are just stupid. Who cares? You know what I mean? We could have just ended there. So then, right when it's getting even better, E-Rock just out of nowhere. What was the exact thing he said?
I guess we were supposed to come back, and instead of playing a bit, because we're talking to Robert Kennedy's son about his uncle being shot, he just comes in and goes, 1 minute!
1 minute till we're back? Or
yeah.
But it was boisterous and loud because Robert F. Kennedy Jr. has a really fucked up voice that makes him kind of sound like Katharine Hepburn. You noticed that, right, Jimmy?
Yeah, of course.
I just didn't want to reference that in front of a Kennedy. Yeah. So his voice is kind of, he struggles at times, and he talks a little lower and he doesn't struggle as much. So then when E-Rock came in with that 1 minute till we're back thing, the best part of it, I told my wife, Jimmy did not know what to do with himself for a good minute there. He didn't know if he wanted to strangle fucking Eric. He didn't know if he wanted to jump out the fucking window. He didn't know if he wanted to chase down Robert F. Kennedy Jr. and continue the conversation somewhere else. You were just pacing. You didn't know what to fucking do with yourself. You were so, like, and I don't blame you. You were so angry at first. And
I was
just
very
trying
frustrated,
and then trying to just take it all in, what the fuck just happened.
It was like the type of confusion you'd have. Like, picture if you were petting a box of puppies. A small box of puppies, and you were going to pick one. And then someone trudged in and just stepped on one. And then kept walking.
Yeah.
Shock you'd feel.
Yeah. Right.
Well, so I chased him down. I just shook his hand. But he did have to leave. Like, his people got him. Literally, I went out a couple seconds later. They were halfway down the hall.
Well, that's what made the moment so good. He knew he was a very busy man and had to get out of here. But he was feeling it. He liked his time with us. And then Jimmy asked him one little question while we were taking a picture. And he really got into it. He settled in for a little bit. And when Eric did that, I forgot to mention that it obviously stopped everything, instantly. And he went, anyway, I gotta go, and walked out almost in mid-sentence.
E-Rock. Come on.
Mark Norman wasn't here, and he's bothered by it.
Yeah, you don't have an E-Rock button where you can turn him down?
I wish.
Damn.
So, oh, God. But that moment, though, made me laugh all day.
Yeah.
All day.
And plus, when Jimmy, you get angry, it's pretty scary.
But I wasn't even that angry. Anger was there for a minute.
And then frustration.
And then just sadness and revulsion.
There was a bit of disdain in there.
It's kind of like when Chris DiStefano handed that guy a sandwich.
Yeah.
And you were just like, what the fuck are you doing?
Yeah. Like, don't you see how annoyed this guy and you're fucking feeding him?
Well, I love those moments, though.
Oh, yeah, we know you do.
That's where I'm fucking sick, because I'm just enjoying Jimmy's frustration and disdain and anger and everything else that went on. Because he just paced, like, what do I do?
Yeah.
What do I fucking do in this moment with what just happened?
It was like you're trying to drink in what just happened.
Right. with a Kennedy.
And you know, but again, I wasn't going to get any new information from him. But he did say, he would say, oh, I'm not going to talk about this on the air. But
yeah.
The reason he probably doesn't talk about it on the air is just
he's
he gets too
it.
Many crackpots coming to him. Like, I don't think this is because we were being told anything secretive. And he certainly wasn't saying anything I hadn't heard before. But I think that he probably just attracts too many crackpots.
Yeah.
And it was just kind of fun to talk about it with
him. Oh, yeah.
And I'm sure he would discuss it again if we saw him. It's not...
Yeah, no, I didn't feel like we were getting anything new, but it was just fascinating to hear from him. And he really believes that it wasn't just Oswald, which is interesting. Because I would assume the Kennedys are privy to a little more info than you and I. So
you know.
Who knows what he's heard... You know, behind closed doors that has convinced him that there's no fucking way Oswald did it alone.
Well, and honestly, he was saying stuff that was like through almost like out of JFK. Like he was saying things that were kind of like what I saw in the film. But he obviously knew exactly what he was talking about.
Yeah.
That Earl Warren not wanting to do it at first and having to be coerced, you know.
Right.
I don't know if he's ever read Vincent Bugliosi's book. I'd be interested to hear his take on that, but... You know, it makes you can't just dismiss Robert Kennedy's son. Because I was very pro conspiracy for years.
Yeah,
and then I just found conspiracy theorists to be so unreasonable, and I started to like everything I heard that was conspiracy theory. I heard the other explanation for, and it actually just made more sense to me.
Yeah.
So whatever, I'm gonna read the book he recommended. I forget the name of it, but...
A lot of people asked on Twitter.
Yeah, yesterday. I don't remember, guys. I'm sorry. He did recommend one, and I can't remember it. But I'm certainly going to read it.
Yeah.
I want to read what's-his-name's book, too. His book.
Framed.
I want to read Framed about Michael Skakel.
How he talked about that case.
It's really interesting. His cousin. Was that a cousin or a friend of the family or whatever? Or some distant relation?
He referenced him as a cousin, but that side of the family just didn't get along with the Kennedys.
Right.
They were pretty hardcore Republicans.
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't know. I don't know what the actual connection is, though.
And his dad was assassinated.
Oh, boy, was he.
Okay. In the kitchen.
1968.
In the Ambassador Hotel.
Yeah, in L.A.
You know, you've seen that footage.
I don't think I have. I saw the movie.
Can you please just show Robert Kennedy? You've seen it.
Oh, yeah. Pull it up,
baby. Guarantee you've seen it.
Is it the one where he's moving his hair out of his forehead, then he gets shot?
This is American.
Yeah, that's probably it. Well, he hasn't. That's. I think that there's a jump cut. I don't know if you see it.
Mm-hmm.
This is American history.
I think Mark has seen it. You're probably just not. I think you can't not have seen this.
All right.
They just tore the ambassador down recently too. In L.A.
The assassination of Robert F. Kennedy. Here we go.
Yes.
Saigon. That's I just think that.
Boy, it's exciting.
Guy's walking out.
Could make it bigger.
I like the music.
Look at that. Everyone just happy.
God, people had nothing to do back then.
Wait. See, they don't actually have it on tape.
Oh. But all hell breaks loose. And then he's on the ground.
But they got the guy.
Yeah, some Sirhan.
Uh-huh.
One of those guys that talks about himself in the third person.
Right.
He should have just been shot in the fucking temple right there, but...
Whatever happened to that guy?
He's in San Quentin.
He's still alive.
Mm-hmm.
How old is he now?
I mean, he was
a younger guy back then, 70. So 68, 32, 46. You got to go 46 years ago. He was probably in his 20s, right?
I'm gonna guess he's 72.
72?
Creepy.
Yeah, he absolutely...
Sadly, I saw that footage on Forrest Gump. That's where I got that news.
It's a hell of a way to get that news.
Yeah.
So what's going on with you, Mark? Everything good?
Oh, man. It's been just a crazy couple of weeks. Just been on the road. Been jumping around. How about this? I did shrooms on Coney Island on Sunday.
Wow, really?
Is that a new club? I'm so desperate.
I'll get you in.
Was it a door deal?
Yeah. You guys ever do the shrooms?
I did a little bit back in the day, but I didn't do a full dose because I was too fucking scared.
It's the best drug by far.
It was pretty cool. I'm not going to lie to you.
Yeah, there's no hangover. There's no flip-out weirdness. It's all natural. It's all easy.
I did it at a jazz festival back in the day.
Hey.
And laying on a lawn, listening to some jazz. The jazz festival would come to Rochester every summer, and we would go. It wasn't something like we looked at the calendar and couldn't wait,
right.
But it was like, why don't we go check it out?
All right, Dad.
And I swear, my experience is I swear I could hear individual raindrops.
Ooh, that's fun.
I swear that's what I... And then I heard like these voices. And
you're being peed on?
It's the jazz festival, so it wasn't that crowded. And I was telling my friends, what the fuck's up with these people? They're so fucking loud behind us. And then I turned and realized they were way the fuck up the hill.
Oh, shit.
This is my experience as I talk about it in the current day.
You were zooted.
Yeah, we were zooted.
But I'm telling you, it's amazing. I think you would like it, Jimmy.
Did you do it in a cheese sandwich?
Nah, we just eat them.
See, old school, you had to prepare, and you would make a cheese sandwich and then put the shrooms in the sandwich.
Uh-huh.
Everyone had a full sandwich, and I went with a half sandwich because I was
you were nervous.
A pussy!
Right, right.
Yeah, I was extremely nervous about
that. Well, you never know your
like
dose. Got to do them.
Yeah,
a bunch.
I wouldn't say that's being a pussy if you're eating like hallucinogenics for the first time, trying not to overdose on them.
Oh, thanks, Jimmy.
That's
I appreciate
it. It's a responsible way to do it.
All these years, I just felt like I was a pussy that I didn't do a full cheese sandwich.
No, you know, if you'd never did it before, it's pretty.
What was your experience, though? Do you, like me with the raindrops and the people being too loud, any weird little things like that?
The weird thing about shrooms is you feel everything and you notice everything. Like, you know, you're staring at a sign, you're like, somebody had to build that sign.
Yes.
And then somebody had to get hired for that. And you just start going off into these weird
that's what I need.
Rabbit
that's
holes.
What I need in my life. Sounds fun. Sit there and analyze who made the stop sign.
It's great.
In front of my life.
It's great. You're like, thank God I don't do shrooms every day, or I'd never get anything done. Because you just sit there and it's so entertaining, and you can.
Yeah.
Deconstruct every little thing, and it's amazing. It's a great time.
A lot of people I used to hang out with way back in the day, they went from shrooms and they jumped right to the acid. That's when I tapped out. I'm like, there's no fucking way. I'm not brave enough to do acid.
Acid's a little crazier.
Right.
But yeah, we went to some casino, and I just realized how much I hate casinos. I'm
Why?
Not a casino guy. Like, I don't know. My idea of fun is not sitting around a table with a stern Asian woman staring at me, just throwing cards down. I don't know. I'm not a fan. I don't like the bells and the lights. I hate it.
I'm with you, but when we were doing the virus tour back in the day, and we all went to Vegas, and you get a table of the guys, when you're all together playing, I think we were playing three-card poker at the time.
Yeah.
Patrice, I think Bob Kelly was at the table, and Anthony, and I don't know if you sat down for some time. That's when it's beyond fun, when you get a cool table. But you're right. Most of the time, you're sitting next to...
Let's
just say it's some stiff Asians.
Right,
I think you could say it.
Yeah.
The Asians tend to get a little stiff when they're gambling. And
right.
They don't want to have any fun whatsoever.
You ever see the end of The Deer Hunter when they're playing Russian roulette?
Yeah.
That's how it is. The fucking... No!
Punchy bow! Yeah, that movie's... But yeah, shrooms are great. I had a great time. And Coney Island's fucking insane. It's just every different ethnicity jumping around and playing music.
Oh, yeah. Did you see the Wanderers or the Warriors there? Damn it, wrong reference.
Come out and play.
So
yeah.
It's safe for Whitey to go back to Coney Island finally? Are you here to tell us?
Whitey was all over the place. I mean, the beach is gross, and it's the most hideous people on the planet, you know, on that beach, just sitting down, making out. It's horrifying. But
that sounds like an awesome time to check out.
It's a great time, and on shrooms, you know, when somebody's ugly and then you're on shrooms, they are fun to look at, you know. It's just like weird looking. It's like Dr. Seuss characters. And you know, you go pee and you're like, gee, look at the guy's dick in the urinal, and you're like, good lord, it's crazy looking.
You're checking out dicks in the urinal?
I check out dicks.
See, it's not gay because you're on shrooms.
Absolutely. Yeah. Even when you're not.
Yeah.
You're on shrooms, it's not gay. Come on.
But
just trying to get a loft.
Yeah, you're looking at other mushrooms. It's fine.
Yeah, there you go.
I want more mushrooms.
Yeah. Those tasted really bad. But yeah, fun times. And
did you go on any rides?
I never do the rides. I don't get roller coasters.
My problem is I got the kids getting up to that age where they want to do rides.
Right.
And I went on a wimpy roller coaster down in Wildwood when we were off. I was a little scared on the little wimpy one.
Oh, yeah?
I'm like, how am I going to handle Disney when we finally go?
Oh, yeah. Not into it.
Yeah, I won't
I've
do it.
I've never been a ride person. But
never. I won't do it.
What's the point? It's like, let me stand in line to be jerked around and scream for a while.
I know. It's like a relationship.
Exactly.
So, Travis likes roller coasters. He likes
Travis, roller coasters. Travis is almost a fanboy of roller coasters,
no,
dare
I
say.
No, I wouldn't say that.
Well, but you'll go on any of them.
He's sure, yeah. Oh,
he's
absolutely.
Like one of those roller coaster aficionados. They're called douches.
Says the boy who's scared to go on one.
Yes, I am. Very frightened.
I'm surprised you're allowed on with that height.
We're like the same height.
What are you, 5'8"?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm 5'11".
Oh, all right.
Are you really?
No.
I'm 5'6". So what's the biggest, most scary one?
I don't know if I've been on a scary. Well, I would say
you don't get scared of anything.
Come on,
no, not really.
Would you go on that one that just dropped? Like, what's the free fall one at Great Adventure?
I've done that. That's terrifying.
Yeah,
free of course fall? It is.
Yeah, just like that the elevator thing that
it's
just
like
falls?
A yeah, long stick and you just sit around yeah. it in a chair and yeah. fall. Yeah, it's insane.
What if, awesome.
That sucks.
It's hell.
Yeah. Well, how why long would you want to put your body through that?
I know. And you shit seconds. A little. It's brutal.
Yeah, rules.
That make me sick.
We used to like when we were teenagers, we would put a penny in our hand and then you know you fall and the penny stays up in the air because of gravity.
Uh-huh.
Because you're falling.
Well, you teenage little years were wild. Well, what gang were you in?
That was after I did acid like a dozen times.
Yeah. So wait, you, that's scary. The worst part to me would be going up too. Like right. that's gotta be tick, tick, tick,
well,
tick,
that's
tick.
Well, that's why it's so,
I think the best roller coaster I've ever been on is King Ka.
Yeah. Who now? What?
A great adventure.
I'm getting nauseous thinking about it.
It's, yeah. That's the best one I've ever been on.
Is that the one where you hang?
No, that's the
your
one.
Your where, legs don't dangle on that one?
No. That's a Batman or Superman. It's been so long since I've
Isn't it easier when your legs are hanging? It's not as scary?
I don't know.
Okay, go ahead. Sorry, I interrupted, but I
No, you didn't.
I was just fine. Curious about the this dangling legs.
This is joking.
Yes, I don't get it.
No, I don't want to do this. I'm sorry.
I'm going to Disneyland next month.
Yay!
I've never been, and there's a great roller coaster that I'm very excited to go on.
What's the roller coaster?
California Screamin'.
California Screamin'. Oh. Mm. California Screamin'. Such a right? They're going to play that a lot.
This stuff makes me. I wish I didn't get motion sick, but I do. I'd be a terrible astronaut.
Do a little. Yeah. That's what you get out of it.
For many reasons.
Yeah. I like heights or throwing up.
Imagine you just get through the program even though you just have horrible motion sickness.
Oh, I would be so bad at this.
They would be so annoyed by
this
you.
This part I like going straight
and
trying to bumble with that giant astronaut glove on.
Why laugh, Eric? I would enjoy just on a flat surface, roller coaster on a flat surface that goes fast around turns. I'm
with Jimmy. I'm all for the tram ride.
Yeah.
Oh, you're not a ride guy.
Tranny? No, not at all.
How long did that last? That was only about 1 minute.
it's 1 minute to go, I believe. Yeah. 1 minute to go.
They have some. Did people ever die on these?
All the sure. time, Mark.
I don't
all
know. I think they're pretty safe.
We
to
lose
be honest.
A few every year.
People have died on roller coasters. People get their legs ripped off. And
it's
scalps
the
ripped off.
Oh, really?
From hair.
Sure. Yeah.
Most amusement parks. It's very rare, but it's when the local guy comes into town and sets up his rides. Oh, yeah. We lose a few every year around this country.
Mr. Rat Tail comes in with his Ferris wheel.
Yeah, a bolt just wasn't tightened properly. Yeah. Or the bolt was a little old and snapped, and somebody goes flying out of one of those swings or something into the trees. Oh, yeah, we get a few of those every year.
This one looks awesome. This is a Joker?
Yeah, and it spins while it's on the track.
No,
it's so slow. Oh, my God.
He's going to vomit.
You don't need that in your life.
Brutal.
Did people get sick on it?
They must.
Sure they did.
Sure they do. Yeah.
What happened in your life that you need this?
Right. How about a conversation and a beer?
Why would you do this?
I mean, I can't. I'm trying to think of what it would take to get me on that. I mean, in all honesty, it looks scary. Like, not even that crazy.
Now you're upside down.
Yeah. Right. Do you go backwards?
Uncomfortable.
Yeah.
It's not even that high.
No, it's not. It's not
just,
that bad at all.
It's just the spinning
the
part.
Of it.
I don't think I'd be scared. I think I'd be more just completely nauseous. I think I would be puking.
It would be fun to be. Like,
I can't even watch this.
Wow, look at that.
Spinning 360 degrees.
That's just so unenjoyable.
Yeah, no, I don't.
I envy people that can enjoy this.
They really enjoy it, too.
Oh, they live for this shit.
Are they all wearing the same shoes? That's so tacky.
Those are test dummies, Jim.
Huh?
Those are test dummies.
Are they really?
Yeah.
They're all wearing white boots.
Yeah, there you go. Those people are not real.
I thought maybe they just gave you white. I want to see the one that drops. What's the dropper one?
I think it's just called Free Fall.
No, but the one in Vegas where they drop,
ooh.
And you're still way the fuck up in the air.
Oh, that's
right?
The stratosphere.
Oh, fuck
oy vey.
God damn!
What's
why
the
would
one
you
where it's
do
like a,
that?
It's like a cage and you bounce in it. It's like got two ropes. You know? And then there's always that famous viral video of the woman slipping out of it. Oh. She's like, oh my God! The other girl's laughing.
The ball.
No, the fat kid's falling out. There's a fat kid falling out.
Right.
Well, I don't know if I've ever seen this video.
Oh, it's a classic.
No, Free Fall is not a roller coaster. This is the one that just goes up and drops.
Find what Mark's talking about, too. I want to see that. Is that the one where they slingshot you in the air?
Yeah.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
And one woman's not strapped in properly or something like that.
And just losing her fucking mind.
Yeah, you can tell she's like facing death in her mind. She's like, this is it, I'm going to die.
Are you sure it's her or it's not a kid, a guy?
Maybe it's a boy. Huh. It's like a fat boy.
Yeah, fat boy.
It's like
fat
a E-Rock.
Boy. Throwing a ball.
You know, before we get too far away from you doing the shrooms, it leads to one of the big stories today. In Brooklyn, they had some... they had zombies all over the place because they, it's right on your front. I don't have my papers in front of me. Could someone grab those for me?
Yeah.
What was it? It's the synthetic marijuana that
K2.
The K2 that the kids are digging these days.
Mm, K2.
And about 33 people in Brooklyn were all over the fucking streets and
really?
On park benches and stuff. They're calling it Zombie Land.
Oh, that's
mind twisting drug turns 33 into Brooklyn's Walking Dead.
Wow.
And they're saying it was the K2.
What is K2? I've never heard of it.
It's a smokable synthetic drug.
Ooh. Oh, also, there he is. Look, it's a young E-Rock. Oh, shit.
Where is it? Let me see.
We can K2, we can got me all hopped up now. Oh, my. He's like, is he slipping out?
He's getting strangled.
And she has no idea.
Right. What is he saying? Is there audio on
he's
this?
Praying Allah.
Oh, all right. It's just one of those fucking... Oh, this kid, that's hilarious. I've never seen that. Tweet that out to the people. He looks like he's getting choked to death.
She's laughing.
Yeah.
Oh, this poor kid.
Anyway, the K2, synthetic drug, also called fake weed, legal high, or spice, can also be added to water. Anyway.
Oh, spice. I've heard of that.
You've heard of spice?
Yeah.
Ooh.
Great channel.
It's only a misdemeanor if you have this stuff.
All right.
I think a lot of people get them from the smoke shops and online and all that, right? But anyway, all over Bushwick yesterday, people were just on the sidewalks and just all over the fucking place, just zooted, as we like to say.
That's a great time to mug someone, I guess.
Why would you do the K2 when you could just get regular weed? I guess this is way stronger than regular weed. Is that what they're saying?
Yeah, and any deaths?
Huh?
Any deaths?
I don't think so.
Oh, okay.
They're just saying just 33 just were extremely fucked up. Okay, yeah, 10 times the effects of THC.
Oh, there you go.
So there you go.
Oh, look at that kid.
Yeah, just on. The videos online are pretty fucking good.
Look at this.
Oh, shit. He's just leaning against a fire hydrant, tipping over slowly.
Josh got this one. Look. Young dude, bro.
Wow, they look like statues.
It's like Tai Chi.
That's crazy.
This guy just walked around Bushwick just filming some of the people on the K2 yesterday.
Why were they all on it yesterday? Was it one bad batch?
Yo, this is best stop, Bushwick, Myrtle Broadway.
Well, then someone else, I was reading the article, and they said that this is becoming quite the problem in that area.
Mm.
Quite the problem. It's a hotbed of activity for the K2. So, and yesterday it was 33 people.
Damn.
Right. You wouldn't do the K2, would you?
Nah, I'm not a fan of weed, really.
Oh, really?
Nah, it just fucks me up. I get in a corner, I hold my knees. It's not good.
Anyway.
But the shrooms, they pump you up. They make life amazing. Everything looks great, and you're having a good time. You're laughing.
Complete focus. Extreme focus.
Extreme focus, and you're very with it.
And that did the full dose.
Yeah, I took a couple caps, couple stems. I was on cloud nine.
There you go. Good for Mark Norman.
Is that illegal, shrooms?
Oh, God, of course.
Yeah.
It just feels weird. Like, I was sitting there on the beach with this bag of literally just plants and mushrooms, and a cop drove by, and I was like, is this bad? Just having a good time. Mm. So weird when you think people go to jail for this, just like a plant in a bag.
Right.
Crazy.
We're finally getting past that.
I think so.
As a society, we're getting there.
Yeah.
They're leaving the weed people alone, finally.
Right.
And I think they should.
Yeah.
If you allow drinking, holy fuck, then you should allow weed. It's so obvious to just about anyone that has a fucking brain.
I know.
Except for these dopey politicians.
Yeah.
Is Chris Christie a big anti-pot guy?
Oh, big time.
Uh-huh.
Big time, to the point, families are moving out of Jersey because they need the medical marijuana for their kids and stuff.
It's funny because he looks like he has the munchies. Oh, boy, killed me.
He's on the short list for Trump.
Oh, wow.
It's down to three guys. Christy Newt and that, what's his
Newt?
Name?
Newt? Newt he wants to take?
Yeah.
I forgot about Newt.
They said if he follows his gut, he'll go with Christy. If he wants to be smart, he goes with that other guy. What's his name? Pence? Anybody? Anybody on this?
You got to wear them.
He was the one that introduced him yesterday at the rally. Is it Pence?
Yes.
Pence, right?
Pence, huh?
They said most people that know way more about politics than certainly we do, they said the smart choice would be this Pence guy. But it's down to three. Pence, Christie, or Newt Gingrich.
Okay.
I thought there was a fourth one.
Wow.
Isn't there some kind of military guy? Like a general or colonel or something?
I don't know. I heard those three this morning, so maybe they knocked the fourth guy out, and now it's down to the three. But all that's going to be decided very, very soon. The convention is coming up.
I know nothing about politics, but don't you feel like the Trump thing is fizzing out a little bit?
Actually, he's gaining in the swing states.
Well, shows what I know.
I think the novelty factor wears off, so they're not just not talking about every moment now.
Right.
Because there's nothing new. He's not doing anything weird. He's just he's still making a decision. So
okay.
I should adjust what you just said. The headline today is that Clinton is losing in the swing states. We're losing ground in the swing states, so I would assume that means Trump is gaining in the swing states. I made that assumption, but I think that's a safe assumption.
Right.
But I guess she's in a bit of trouble in the swing states right now. And then this fucking Bernie Sanders just proven they're all the same fucking people.
Uh-huh.
He endorsed Hillary yesterday.
Yeah, I heard.
He does not like Hillary Clinton, and they're not on the same page with most of this shit.
Yeah, of course he did.
But he just hates Trump.
But I would respect the guy if he goes, look, I can't endorse anybody. And then everyone is yelling on Twitter, what was he supposed to do, sit out now? Now that he's not in it anymore, he's supposed to sit out? I don't think you're sitting out if you decide you're not going to endorse, your fellow Democrat.
Yeah.
Yeah.
She's either good for the country or she's not. When she was against you, she's no good for the country. When she's against him, she's great for him. Come on.
I think it's as basic as that, Jimmy, but not to people online, man. They'll fight you on this all day long. Bernie Sanders hates Wall Street, and Hillary's, she doesn't mind the Wall Street.
People just don't want to admit that, Bernie is more genuine. But when it comes down to it, he's just as full of shit as the rest. They're all the same.
He would have had a great legacy. He's an older guy. Just say, look, I don't believe in either candidate, so I'm not sitting out. I'm just not endorsing anybody.
Yeah.
The Bernie supporters are fucking pissed off. They're bummed out. A lot of the people want their money back.
Oh, shit. That's right.
Because it was a grassroots thing with all the youth of America, especially. We're all,
donating.
Donating to Bernie's candidacy. And then he turns around and he fucking endorses Hillary in the end. And then people are yelling, screaming at me, well, the Republicans did the same fucking thing. And I said, yeah, I know. Well, I yelled the same nonsense when all these guys start, endorsed Trump after basically saying how much they hate his guts.
Yeah.
Cruz took a spot at the convention. He's going to be speaking.
Oh, geez.
I don't know if he officially has endorsed Trump, but now, Trump invited him to speak at the convention, and he took that spot.
Damn.
He fucking hates Trump. If you got him in a room with a couple beers, he would say, I fucking hate the guy.
Yeah.
They're all just fucking full of shit.
Who's this?
Cruz. Cruz.
It's crazy how many people are voting for Trump, but when you ask around, no one will say they like Trump. It's weird. Everyone's hiding it, but then they go vote for him.
Right. It's such a strange election. But
I know.
But my point is, both sides do this horse shit. I would have more respect for the individual politician if they said, look, I don't agree with Trump's politics. I said shitty things about him when we were doing all those debates. So, look, yeah, I'm not going to endorse him. I'm not going to endorse anyone. I think that's okay to say. And Bernie should have said the same fucking thing yesterday.
Yeah, but maybe he just wants to be back in the limelight. Does he get hooked on that? And
I mean, if you really break it down, Bernie got some of his agenda into the Clinton campaign, certainly a little bit, but I don't think enough where he should be now rah-rahing Hillary Clinton.
Yeah,
my God,
ugh,
crazy,
yikes. Well, once again, I do not care about politics.
That's a good place to be.
Yeah.
Because it'll drive you nuts.
Yeah, it's all the same.
It'll drive you nuts. I mean, people, that's all they do is go on Facebook and just fucking fight it out with the other side. They're just having these battles, battle royales on Facebook.
Do you guys want to do bets on Hillary?
What do you mean?
I think she's going to win.
Maybe.
What do you think, Jimbo?
I don't know. Honestly, don't know.
I've thought the whole time that it's her race to lose.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean I like
the white
Hillary.
Race.
I'm just trying to throw logic at it. It doesn't mean I like Hillary.
I don't either.
I truly don't like either candidate. I can't sit here and say I like either one of them.
Yeah.
I started kind of liking Bernie in a weird way, even though that would be horrible for me personally.
So he wants financially?
He wants to take all your money away. But
yeah.
I kind of liked him, and I kind of liked John Kasich on the other side. Those were the two guys they sort of started really focusing on.
Mm-hmm.
But now when it comes down to these two, yeah, I'm not voting. And I guess that's a bad thing if you don't vote. Then you shouldn't have a voice in this country because you're not voting.
Yeah, I've never voted in my life.
I can't vote for either one of these.
Trump has me still, but he's makes it a little hard sometimes.
Not as, but you're weakening a little bit on your position, Jimmy?
No,
a little bit?
Well, he's just doing things, or we said a few things, and I'm like,
You hear what he said about Ginsburg?
Was he joking, though? When he said she resigned for criticizing him, was he kidding or?
No, there it is. Supreme Court Justice Ginsburg doubles down on Donald Trump. Can you get all the Ginsburg stuff for us there, E-Rock? He is a faker, she says. He has no consistency.
Language.
He says whatever comes into his head at the moment. He really has an ego.
It's fair.
And then then Trump, he can't let any of this go. He's tweeting at 1 a.m. And there you go. Thank you, Fox. You're helping the show right now. Justice Ginsburg of the U.S. Supreme Court has embarrassed all by making very dumb political statements about me. Her mind is shot. Resign.
Her mind is shot. That's what you said about your old aunt in the home.
Well, there's that famous video of her where I think it was an Obama State of the Union address or something, and she's just pretty much sleeping. Mm. Her head is completely down.
Oh, yeah?
And she's just snoozing away.
Yeah.
And she's a Supreme Court justice.
Oh, boy.
I've always thought she seems a bit on the older side now.
Yeah.
Battle axe.
I fucked her.
Yeah.
It was a long time ago. It was after a gig.
Yeah.
Wild lady.
A wild lady. So that's your political news.
Are you guys going to Montreal this year?
I think so, yeah. I'm doing a gig.
All right.
And now I'm regretting that I'm not going.
You got to bring the radio up.
We should have.
Now
I'm regretting it.
Not too late.
That's why we did Austin. I mean, the company only gives us maybe one a year.
Yeah.
Maybe we could squeeze two out a year. We probably should have went. Jimmy's going to be up there, though.
All right.
There it is. There she is in the front row. You think she's snoozing there or praying? What's going on there?
That was after.
She's out cold. She's fucking snoozing.
It was after a night with Jimmy. She's done.
That's right.
How old is Ginsburg?
She's 41.
41?
Hard
job. Okay. Wow. I didn't know that.
Jesus.
All right.
I went back to Austin last weekend.
Did you?
And a lot of people from the show came out. It was great.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Where'd you play down there?
A Cap City Comedy Club. Great room.
Right.
I've done that. It's really good.
Yeah. And how about this? I ran into a girl I had sex with down there.
Yeah.
And she goes, I was a little nervous after having sex with you, so I got tested. And I was like, oh, shit. Here we go, because we didn't use a condom. Chlamydia. I can deal with that. Curable.
Wait, you gave her chlamydia?
Apparently.
She's telling you.
Yeah. Hey, I was happy. Out of all of them?
You didn't know you had it?
I didn't know I had it.
Wow.
How do you know you have it?
I mean, it's gone now. It only lasts 10 days in the system. So if we all stop fucking for 10 days, we can get rid of chlamydia. Fun fact.
Oh, is that how it works?
Yeah. Okay.
Wait, so you just have to sit out for 10 days and you're good?
Yeah.
But, I mean...
You could get a penicillin thing or whatever.
She could have fucked someone else, no?
Yeah.
She said she didn't for a while.
All right. Yeah, because I was going to question that. I'm like, that's almost not fair to you.
That's true.
But if she's swearing that you were the only guy she was with for a while, then, you can't question that, I guess.
I was kind of into it. The clap. I had the clap. It's kind of fun. I mean, it's a curable STD. I feel like I got off easy.
Does it give you the leaky dick or anything?
I had no symptoms. I mean, I got a weird, shriveled, tiny raisin, but it's always been like that.
Your bag?
Huh?
Your bag is like a raisin?
No, my dick.
Oh.
Yeah. You got a small one?
No, I'm joking. Oh. It's medium. I hope. I hope it's medium. Let's all measure. Roland, get in here. But yeah, chlamydia, I felt like I got off, with a slap on the dick.
So you're pretty happy about that.
Yes, extremely.
You guys got to use your bags, man. These guys are nuts.
So scared of getting tested that I just never did it. And then, you know.
Right.
Your brain just starts going places. Oh, my God. What do I have? You know.
Oh, God.
You start thinking about all the girls you've railed, you know.
Yeah. I haven't been tested in a while. Oh, I feel good. That's how I judge it by. When I wake up, if I don't tumble out of bed face first, so put that one in the W column.
Test.
Another W for the kid.
Nothing ever? No spots? Crabs? Nothing. Come on, 80s. In the 80s. Everybody crabs in the 80s.
Nothing.
Wow.
But, I mean, I had no problem wearing the bags.
Oh, come on. I hate the bag.
I had no problem. I never thought twice about it.
What?
Swear to God.
Now, you grew up in the AIDS time.
Yeah.
Yeah, you got a bag in 79.
Not that old. Not too far off, but not 79.
All right. Well, when did you graduate high school?
In the early 80s.
82?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. That's not a bad year.
But I didn't get action until college, so.
Oh, really?
No action.
Mm.
Not that action.
Mm-hmm.
A little touching of the puss.
The old finger sniff. But you didn't have a girlfriend in high school that you were...
I did, but there was no... I don't know. It was a different time.
I guess so.
My high school in general, a lot of the guys I hung out with, most of us just didn't get that, you know, all the way action.
Yeah. And yet, Jimmy, you were sniffing panties at 11.
Yeah, we had very different upbringings. I came from a strict household, too, so.
Oh.
Yeah, my mom had a problem with us just having girlfriends as teenagers.
What?
Problem with it, yeah.
Wow.
Very much a problem with that.
What about the masturbation?
Oh, of course.
She was cool with that.
Well, she didn't know.
I didn't know if she was going to ban it.
Oh, no, I don't know. I would assume she knew.
Oh, wow.
That we were just whacking off in our rooms and wherever we could, you know, get a moment.
Especially if she does the laundry.
Seven kids, so
yeah.
You had to find a moment.
That's a lot of semen.
I mean, you had to find, like, a 30-second window where you didn't have a brother or sister around.
Yeah.
And then, man, you would get it done quickly.
And that's one of those things where if somebody's in the shower for, like, just 2 minutes too long, you're like, oh, fuck.
I
know what he's doing in there.
Absolutely right.
Because
that's when probably the only privacy you got in my house. Because we all, you know, shared rooms and everything. There was one, at one point, there was five of us in one room. In two bunk beds.
Holy shit.
Wait, two bunk beds? What am I saying?
So that's four beds and then a regular bed.
Hold on. Why did I just fuck up this math? My twin brothers shared. All right, so that would be two. Yeah. Two sets of bunk beds. Right, okay, yeah.
So four bunks.
Yeah.
Okay, and then another bed.
No.
This is, who are you, fucking Charlie from Willy Wonka?
No. I had the math figured out. All right, two sets of bunk beds. Jesus. So, okay. So then the three older boys, I'm one of those, we all had our own bed in the bunk bed system. And then my twin brothers, who were six years younger than me, they had a share. They had to share theirs. And they were a bit older to be sharing. They went head to toe. And then finally, we made our house bigger.
Thank God.
Then we just knocked down the second level and got a few extra rooms going.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
Yeah.
Like immigrants.
Yeah, pretty much. So, I mean, in that room, you weren't getting anything done.
No.
Although you'd work one out every once in a while. You had to be very quiet.
As
soon as there was one squeak from your bunk bed, you're like, oh, fuck.
Right. You learn how to jerk off without moving.
Yes, all that stuff.
Did you guys do the jerk with the friends where you took a corner of the room?
God, no.
Come on. Sleepovers?
No.
Oh, man. Me neither.
What was the thrill of that?
I mean, you were close with your friends. You put a porno on the TV, and then you got... On that left side of the room, I got on the right side, and you got a sleeping bag going, and yeah.
Oh, no, it was never that.
No.
I would just leave the room.
Oh, wow.
I bet you there's more guys that would call and say they did that.
Yeah.
But no, we never did that.
We talked about technique. Oh, did I ever tell you about the videotape? This is not a Tucker Max story. But one time, me and my friends were all skateboarding in the neighborhood, and we all went back to my friend Phil's house, and we're just... messing around, it's like five of us, and Phil's like, I'm going to take a shower, just do whatever you want in my room. So we're looking through these tapes, and one of them said skateboarding on it, VHS, so we pop it in. Hope I'm not giving too much away here, but It's his sister, naked, just on the tape, like on the TV. And we're like, what the fuck? Oh, and she was like the cute older sister. And we're like, why does Phil have a fucking naked? And his sister's like posing in the mirror.
Right.
And you could see that the camera was hidden in a closet.
Right.
And like, you know, you could see half of a door crack and a door jam. And then it was just her on a, bouncing off a mirror in her naked body. She had a huge bush, big tits. We were like, oh, my God, what the fuck is Phil doing with a picture of his, a video of his sister? Oh, my God. And then Phil like walks in, you know, drying his hair with the towel, you know, a towel around his waist. And we're like, what the fuck is this? And he was like, ah, and he like tackled the TV and turned the video off. And we're like, what are you doing? He's like, I had to blackmail her. She owed me money. But I honestly think that he just wanted to see a naked woman, like in real life. He was curious.
And he videotaped his own sister.
I'm not saying he jerked off to it or got off to it or anything, but I'm saying he had that video.
Right.
And boy, that was a whole different day after that.
Why was it a whole different day after
that? Which is like, he's like, let's go back skate, or let's go get a slice of pizza. And we're just like, we couldn't let it down. We're like, come on, Phil, what's going on? What was that about? It was a whole thing.
You think there were a lot of people that videotaped their older sister when they were going through puberty?
I don't know. He was a smart kid. He was like, he's an engineer now. So I think that was his way of learning about women.
Right. Damn.
Pre-internet, you know? So.
Right.
That's what you did.
Did he get rid of the tape?
He must have, yeah. I mean, he was... It was just a running joke for 8 years after that.
People,
you know, well, why are you late, Phil? Sister in the shower or whatever, you know?
People are saying you're full of shit about the clap.
What do you mean?
Well, let's make sure we get the right info out here. I also heard that Rich Voss had a major meltdown yesterday about our brand new phone system.
I just saw Rich Voss last night.
Maybe we can find that audio. He was losing his mind. I don't know what your name is. Lamar?
Yeah, from Ohio.
What's going on?
What's up, Lamar in Ohio?
I'm good. Jimmy, I saw you a couple of years ago here at the Columbus Funny Bone, man. You're awesome.
Thank you, buddy. I'll be back in Columbus next week.
I know, in Thornville. It's a real shithole.
No, I'm doing the Columbus, I'm doing a theater in Columbus on Thursday.
Right, and the Juggalos in Thornville. Yeesh.
Yeah, I've done it before. They're good.
I hear nothing but good things from those guys and their fan base when it comes to comedians.
Yeah, they're really good, man.
Yeah.
All right. I may check it out.
What do you got?
But anyways, yeah, long story short, man, you can't just wait out chlamydia. You can't be asymptomatic. He's right about that. You may show no symptoms, but you still have to go to the doctor and get tested, and they're going to treat it regardless. And usually with chlamydia comes gonorrhea. They usually piggyback each other.
Okay.
And while you're at it, Mark, you may want to get tested for HIV, too.
Jeez.
Yeah, I'm just saying.
Ari Shaffir told me if you wait 10 days, it goes away.
Well, you
believed Ari over a doctor?
Well, Ari's like 58.
Oh, Mark. He ain't gonna make it.
I haven't been to a doctor in a decade.
I'm punching out.
Oh, God, you just took your advice from Ari Shaffir.
Yeah, I know.
But he's an older guy, so he's probably looks at it differently. Like, if I get anything now.
Yeah, Ari was at the original Woodstock.
Right, by the time it kicks in, who gives a fuck?
Right. Ah, shit. Wish we can get Ari on the phone. He told me a whole different rigmarole.
He just said, wait 10 days?
Yeah.
We can get Dr. Steve on for you.
Oh, that would help.
All right, let's get Dr. Steve on.
See if he can test me, too, and give me some antibiotics.
We could do that.
I don't want to pay the bill. I don't have health insurance.
Yeah, chlamydia is it doesn't just go away. It's not a head cold.
Yes,
symptomatic.
Yes.
Yeah.
Are you playing the Pokemon Go?
No, I don't get it. I don't play any of that.
Everyone's
shit.
Playing. I walked home yesterday. Everyone's on their fucking phones, looking, and playing Pokemon Go.
What's the deal? Why is it so?
It just exploded.
Yeah.
It's only been out there like less than 2 weeks, I believe. And there's this just... Oh, we have Dr. Steve ready?
It's an adventure.
Before we go on to the Pokemon? I thought I saw the phone. Is that him? Are we ready? Anyone?
Do we have anybody in there?
Let me see.
So chlamydia can turn into gonorrhea.
Well, we're going to find out.
I didn't know they could morph into other diseases.
We're going to find out in a second. I think we're... We're just seeing if Dr. Steve could talk right now. This new phone system's a little weird. I'm trying to figure it all out. It's very strange. It's just ringing? All right. Travis is trying to get him on the line for you. So give us a second here.
He's fired.
I just called.
The Pokemon Go is just all the rage.
Yeah, I don't get it. I saw a guy playing and I was like, this looks awful. Like, even Tetris has more graphics.
Yeah, you're swiping to catch a little circle monster.
Yeah.
It's fucking ridiculous.
Well, me and Travis took care of Jimmy this morning. There were some Pokemon monsters in this studio.
Uh-oh.
And we took them out so Jimmy can be safe today.
Were they on K2?
Well, the problem is that people are playing the game at the Holocaust Museum.
Well,
and they're begging people, please don't play Pokemon Go at the Holocaust Museum.
Right.
Arlington Cemetery is now checking in. We do not consider playing Pokemon Go to be appropriate decorum on the grounds of ANC. We ask all visitors to refrain from such activity.
Uh-huh.
Also Ground Zero here in New York City. They did a story down there. They're showing people really happy and excited at the 911 Memorial playing Pokemon Go.
They should get some shots of them playing at my shows.
The fact that we need to tell people, don't play Pokemon Go at the 9/11 or Holocaust memorials.
Yeah, but what if it's a really rare Pokemon?
I stand corrected.
See?
Yeah, I think they're putting the rare ones in those locations, you know, making it a little more challenging.
Yeah, that's just so weird.
Let me ask you this. Can you take the 911 Memorial seriously and play Pokemon Go at the same time? Same time.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, I could do that.
If you're down there and you're really, you know, feeling the heaviness of that area, but then all of a sudden maybe a little relief. I'm just asking. I don't know how I feel about this.
So you're saying they're different games in different areas. That's how it works?
There's different Pokemon in different areas.
Oh,
I
didn't know that.
There's different creatures in water-based areas.
Oh, that sounds so
shut up, Kirk.
Fun.
Nobody wants to
talk to you. I spent the day yesterday. I was playing Pokemon. It was really good.
Pokemon?
Not the game.
Pokemon. That's a different game.
Yeah, a very different game.
I was enjoying myself. I was Pokemoning all day.
Hey, what level are you on, Kirk?
I don't even know. Just level fun? I mean...
you got to get to level 5, then you can hit the gyms, and now you're fighting other people and stuff.
Oh, you play at the gym.
Were you Pokemon?
Not the actual gym.
Yeah, I was Pokemoning 5 minutes ago.
Yeah. Yeah, we
what else am I supposed to do here?
Right.
I'm Pokemon.
It's a hotbed for Pokemon.
Is it?
Yeah.
See, there's a screen cap of someone. That's what someone saw on their phone yesterday.
Oh, okay.
Right on the engravings.
Oh, a slowpoke right there?
They should at least put a turban on it, you know? If it's going to be a 9/11, put a little turban on the guy. Make it more
then it would be
topical.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh my God. It's like, then you're fighting evil.
Oh, okay. Dr. Steve doesn't have much time, so we got to go right to him.
Oh, he's dying. Cool. yeah, I'm putting a toe tag on myself as we speak.
I don't know.
Hello?
Are you there, Steve? I don't know.
Yes.
Oh, you are there.
Oh, wow, your phones are different.
Yeah, I don't like this. The company put this new system in for everybody. I don't know what the problem was with the old system, but now we got all sorts of bugs, and they're going to have to figure this shit out and tweak it a bit. But anyway.
Hey, let me ask you something before you ask me that. Did you guys talk about what they did in Pokemon Go at the Westboro Baptist Church?
No.
So you got to look that up.
That's a good story.
Creators of Pokemon apparently have a rakish sense of humor because the Westboro Baptist Church has a Pokemon site on it, and the Pokemon that you can get there is a little pink Pokemon called Clefairy.
Oh, fun.
Wait, called what?
Clefairy. It's like a gay Pokemon.
Oh, that's hilarious. They must be losing their minds.
Yeah, they got all these fucking nerds over there with their little cell phones picking up the Clefairy Pokemon at the West Coast.
And you throw an AIDS ball at it.
So Mark Norman was back down in Austin, Texas, ran into a girl that he had sex with. And she basically told him that he gave her chlamydia. And then Mark Norman said, Ari Shaffir said, look, you just sit out for 10 days and the chlamydia goes away.
Wow. Ari is usually right about most things.
Ah, shit.
And Mark was very excited when he got this news.
Yeah, Mark thought he went through his fucking 10-day chlamydia thing.
Yeah.
His chlamydia cleanse.
That was like a gun thing. Well, if you wait long enough, you get a permit.
It'll that's right. It'll go away in 10 days if you take doxycycline or another antibiotic, but by itself, no, it can smolder.
Smolder?
Doxycycline? Sounds like a new exercise thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'll tell you one thing, it doesn't work out. Doesn't get that funny bone going.
So what do I do? Because that was months ago.
The Zithromax Z-Pack, you know, that will give you for a sinus infection. If you take four of those tablets at once, you can get rid of chlamydia, too. So
I can get a Z-Pack at CVS?
Yeah, well, you have to have a prescription for it.
Ah, but, fuck.
Now the thing is, how did she tell you that you gave her chlamydia? How do you know that you actually have it? That's the thing.
I don't. So, I just assumed if she had it, she got it from me.
Well, would imply that you're the only person that she's ever had sex with.
I think in a while, yeah.
Well, what's she gonna say?
Well, I mean, it's possible. The thing to do is to get tested, and you can get just treated. Some doctors will just treat you, but to know for sure if you really have it and to be screened for other STDs, you know, what they do is they take a little Q-tip and stick it up your cock hole.
Ah,
how much does that cost?
Jesus.
God damn. That's the only way? It's 2016.
Well, that is the best way, and because with chlamydia, you want to get some of the cells and, you know, in the urethra itself. It doesn't feel good, I'll tell you that, but it's only about 10 seconds. And then they can test you for chlamydia, gonorrhea.
Dr. Steve, you want us to get a sample for you, get a nice smear and mail it to you?
Yeah, I can walk you guys through it. Sure.
You want us to help you out there, Mark?
Does it work if I'm hard?
But the other option is just to treat empirically, which means you just treat without really knowing what you're treating, and the Zithromax is the way to do it.
I think I'm just going to get those Z-Packs. Knock it out.
Yep.
Get a Z-Pack, knock it out.
But how do I get the prescription?
One gram once will knock out chlamydia.
But how do I get the... Can you write me a prescription?
Well, not technically, but we can talk later. And
please, I'm dying here. I don't want to go to the. I don't want to go to a. I don't have health care.
The ixnay on the prescription
thing. Well, you still have to go to a doctor. You got to get tested.
Yeah, Dr. Steve just got himself another client.
Yeah, I'll pay you under the table, whatever you like.
Oh my God!
All right,
I'll kiss you.
You should. You should get the Z-Pack.
Here, and I'm fucking naked down here on my.
So. Oh, nice.
Oh, awesome.
Oh, you're looking at a little porn before work, are you?
Right. Yeah, I like to crank my pud to this. Right. Yeah, this is people with missing limbs.
I'm not going to let the dog in.
Yeah.
Right.
Oh, great. That's how you know he's close to coming when he yells that. Right.
My family's up. My family's upstairs eating French toast. I'm down here pulling my pud.
All right, boys.
All right. Dr. Steve, Weird Medicine on this fine channel.
Yep, 10 p.m. Saturdays and other times at E-Rock's pleasure.
I love that you had that. All right, you good, Mark?
Yeah, I got to get the Z-Pack, but I'll tell you about that prescription.
All right.
Yeah, somebody give Mark my number.
Thank you, sir.
All right.
All right.
We'll figure some shit out. All on the up and up. All right. Is that how you get rid of... I don't know how to hang up on people or anything. These phones do suck, but I'm not going to lose my mind like Rich Voss did last night.
You'll never find it if you fucking Voss lost his mind. Something that small.
That should be the new Pokemon game. Find Rich Voss's brain somewhere in New York City.
It's like a little pot seed.
Yes.
Yes. How do you lose his mind?
He was just mad that the phones were new, and I don't know. Maybe I think Eric's trying to find a clip. If it's worth playing, I thought it was worth playing. I love when someone loses their mind on the radio. Hey, any more Pokemon stories worth talking about? We got the Holocaust Museum. We got the 911 Memorial here in New York. Then we got the ones, people being robbed. We did a few of those. Oh, the cheating. Yes. Pokemon Go is apparently now, waiting for the headline, now catching couples cheating on each other.
What? How so?
Well, I guess it records where you're collecting these Pokemons.
Yeah, and then you can see it
and then
in the app.
Yeah, and then I guess your girlfriend or wife grabs your phone and is like, what the fuck? You captured some Pokemons right around the neighborhood of your old girlfriend.
I see.
What were you doing in that area catching Pokemons?
Mm-hmm.
I think that's the gist of the story, right?
I didn't read that one because I don't necessarily believe it.
Mm-hmm.
It just it seems like something someone would say to get in the news.
They should do a Shut story up, about people who are Pokemoning and then just laughing together.
You don't believe that story?
It's not that I don't believe it. It's that I could totally see it being fake.
Is there a map?
Oh, I got busted cheating because I was playing the game that everyone's talking about, so now I'm in the news.
You know? But is there? Do they tell you where you got these Pokemons on your phone?
Yeah, like if you click on a specific character, you can see exactly where you caught it.
Okay.
So theoretically,
it's possible.
There's not a chlamydia Pokemon that you can fucking.
Yeah. So you think they're pretty much making a giant leap here?
I wouldn't be surprised, but to make the leap from like you know. This is where I caught a Pokemon to, well, you're cheating on me.
Yeah, this is the part I read in the story, and I was like, all right. It says she opened up her boyfriend Evan's game and saw his recent gameplay, which this seems like they're just faking this part of the story, like Travis said, just to make that jump, which also told her where he was at, and it certainly wasn't anywhere near their house. Lo and behold, she saw that he was suspiciously in the same neighborhood as his ex-girlfriend when he was catching Pokemon.
Come on, that guy didn't have a girlfriend.
That sounds like they kind of needed a little help with their story, right?
Yeah, but I mean, the thing's doing fine. People are playing.
Right. What are the Pokemon stories? Did we do all of them for today?
I think so for today, yeah.
People are getting robbed.
Oh, yeah? Oh,
yeah, because the robbers, they're like, oh, fuck, people are going to be coming to this particular area to, you know, to get some shit in the game, and then they're being held up.
Like sitting ducks.
It's sort of an out-of-the-way area.
Interesting.
I think there's going to be a lawsuit sooner than later because of this Pokemon Go. I hope they figured all that shit out before they release this.
Yeah.
Because it's this game. I mean, if you haven't noticed this just walking around New York?
I saw one guy in Bryant Park doing it, and I was like, what is that? And he was like, you don't know about this?
Right.
And I just kept walking.
I walked through Central Park on the way home yesterday. It was, you could just tell. It was just.
Really?
I don't know. I can't put a number on it, but it was just everywhere. I just saw.
People are always looking at their phones, so I never noticed.
No, but they were looking at it in a different way. Like they're, you know, they're kind of. Looking up and at the phone at the same time.
Which is
the giveaway.
If you see someone randomly stop on the sidewalk, that's exactly what they're doing.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, because they're close to a place where you could get Pokeballs.
Aha, uh-huh. Pokeballs.
Pokeballs, and then
all right.
And that's, you know, you need those to fight the, you know, and capture the Pokemons.
Have you guys played it? Have you tried it?
No, I haven't.
I set it up for my kid, Mark.
Sure.
Set it up for my kid, and then... I when I got home yesterday, I handed him the phone and said, look what I got.
Yeah.
And he was excited for maybe 5 seconds.
All right.
then I realized I just did it for my fucking self. I'll be out of this, though, soon, right, Travis? You will, too?
We'll see.
Oh, really?
I mean, it's fun.
It's fun for now. It's a weird phenomenon.
Until something else gets my attention.
Right.
Something to do while I'm going from the subway to home. And then.
How about you think? How about you talk to the Lord?
What does that even mean?
All right, we're gonna take a break. We got some Joe Paterno.
It's an allegation, yeah.
It certainly is an allegation.
Where's our food?
From 1976. That's why I was stalling, but I guess we're going to have to go to break without
the food. I'm obsessed with fucking Lady Gypsy.
You want to play it?
It's all
play
I
it.
Think of.
Can we play the whole song?
Wait, there's a video. This is why anyone who doesn't like Ricky Gervais, I just don't get it. How do you not understand how amazing fucking Gervais is?
I would assume most people just like him, though. And
well, people, because he's so popular, sometimes people get annoyed by him. So whenever you're that popular and people know your real opinions, people find reasons to be pissed at you. But to not understand how great David Brent is, after all these years, he's created something again. It makes me sick to my stomach. This fucking video is David Brent doing Lady Gypsy. And it's a good enough song where you're like, okay, that's a song. It's not so over the top. Like, wow, it's crazy bad.
Right.
You listen to it, you go, I get it.
Right.
But then the video is just, he's such a fucking ass. That outfit he is wearing in this is, it's a masterpiece of fucking terrible.
Oh my God, it's a white t-shirt where he rolls up the sleeves all the way. And he's got a scarf around his neck.
But the fucking, when he walks out this side, it's like you can't not.
And he's trying to like.
He's got the fucking the branch coming out like it's a dick. He's just stupid.
he's sitting on a branch off a tree in the woods, going for that type of feel.
And the gypsy, her dance is enraged. She's just dancing around with that shitty fucking shawl. It's terrible. It's great.
We'll tweet it out to the people off our show account, but let's play it for the people.
Oh, I love it.
For Ricky Gervais.
Yeah, I want to see it.
For David Brent.
Of course it's for David Brent, Lady Gypsy. Oh, bravo. Wow. Wow, the movie's coming out soon. Oh, August 19th.
We should go out there from there.
Huh?
We should go out there from
London only.
Let's go to London. Get Don Wicklund on it. All right, we should take a break. That is wonderful. We tweeted out the video
that's
for the
great.
People.
The song's not bad.
No, that's the beauty of it.
Yeah.
That's what makes that's it. That's why it's so good, is right. Because the song is actually a decent number.
It's a bit catchy.
He also posted the audio for another track on his Twitter.
Is that the only video?
Life. That's the only video thus far.
What's the other track called?
Life on the Road.
Life on the Road.
That's good. I like Lonely Cowboy the best.
Can I get Dr. Steve's number?
You're freaking out.
At break?
Yes. A bed of heather.
I want to get those.
And he gestures. I just noticed that this time, yeah. When he says a bed of heather, and the hand just goes out like this is the bed of heather.
Yeah.
We got Mark Norman today. He's got Funny Bone in Syracuse Thursday through Sunday. What else you got, Mark?
Please come out to that this weekend. And next week, I'm at a Providence Comedy Connection. And then after that, I'll be in Montreal doing an hour show, a couple hour shows in Portland, in Helium Portland, Oregon. And then some other stuff. It's all on the website, marknormancomedy.com. And listen to my podcast, Tuesdays with Stories.
Yes, with Joe List. You guys do a very good job. Jim Norton.
I have this Thursday, Columbus at the Capitol Theater. This Friday, Thornville, Ohio, I'll be at the Gathering of the Juggalos. The two dates that have moved, we didn't want to cancel them.
Wait, did you say this Thursday?
This coming Thursday.
Columbus?
No, I'm sorry.
It's next Thursday.
I apologize. The 21st, July 21st, yeah, thank you. Yeah. Minneapolis and Pittsburgh have moved to September because we had to clear some dates over the summer. But those have been rescheduled for September 15th and 16th is Minneapolis and Pittsburgh. The Pittsburgh theater changed because I think the theater wasn't available on the date. But we had this. It's the only thing I could do, so I didn't have to cancel the date.
Right.
So I apologize for that. Hopefully those of you who bought tickets for these two gigs can still make it.
There you go.
It's on my website correctly.
Now. Yeah, JimNorton.com.
Oh, and the UFC Unfiltered will be out tomorrow, the newest one. We're taping it today, and it comes out about 12 hours later.
There you have it. Now we eat. What do you mean, what the fuck is this shit?
Yeah, I like
that's,
that.
That's yacht Rock or Yacht Radio? I forget. Huh?
Yacht Rock Radio.
Have you checked out Yacht Rock Radio yet?
No, I was getting
into
that.
Oh, it's all the rage this summer.
Yeah.
I believe it's Channel 18. Someone told me it's Channel 18. I think it's 18.
Channel 18.
I know it is. I actually listen to Yacht Rock Radio, and they play a little Christopher Cross. Changes it up a little bit there, Mark Norman.
I'm into it.
Not everything has to be fucking loud and in your head.
Yeah.
Calm down a little bit and just chill out.
I hear you.
We got Paul Feig coming in a little while from Ghostbusters. I saw Ghostbusters.
Oh, please do tell.
I liked it.
Come on, who paid you to say it?
That's what people are saying online.
No, yes, you hate it, you love it.
I liked it.
All right.
And someone asked me, I would give it like 2.5 out of 4 stars.
Okay.
I wasn't blown away by it, but I didn't hate it.
All right.
I liked it. It was a bit scarier than the original.
Oh.
A couple little scares.
There's a lot of Twitter buzz going, saying all the men in it are, every man is portrayed as either an idiot, a retard, a dummy, a
yeah, but I know,
douche.
I know we rule, so it doesn't bother me. When you know you rule, then, make fun of it. I don't give a fuck.
I see.
Men rule.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, we're We're pieces of shit, basically, in this movie.
But then the counter argument from them is, well, now you know how we feel.
Whatever.
As a lady in every movie. And my thing is, well, then why are you doing it to other people?
Right.
Shouldn't you know then?
I'm in the whatever camp. Have fun with it. Who gives a fuck?
There you go.
They hire a male secretary, and he's a dummy.
Oh, okay.
It's that guy. We had him in once. I always forget his name.
Chris Hemsworth.
Henley?
Yeah, Hemsworth, right.
Oh, Hemsworth.
Oh, the good-looking secretary.
Yeah, okay, yeah. Very good-looking and dumber than a box of rocks. So
got it.
I kind of laughed, like, ah, whatever. Have fun, ladies.
Right.
Have
right.
fun making us look stupid. We did enough to you over the years.
I hear you.
And they're the only ones that could really, you know, fight the ghosts, the ladies.
Oh, okay.
I didn't mind the movie. I really didn't mind the movie. I certainly liked it. I laughed a few times.
All right.
Special effects were pretty good. The Ghostbusters song was really just stupid.
Oh, they have a reboot of the Ray Parker Jr. classic?
They have three or four songs, right? How many do they have?
And
throughout the whole movie, it's a different version of the Ghostbusters theme. Am I right, Paul?
I've only heard the Fall Out Boy one.
Oh, well, the Fall Out Boy
one. There's a couple ones, but yeah, the Fall Out Boy one, and then there's more of a...
Wow, 6 million hits.
It's not good.
You like it?
Ooh, this
is as good as Prince's Bat Dance?
Bat Dance is better.
This is, it's comparable. This song is comparable to the Bat Dance.
Is this David Brent?
This is Fall Out Boy doing the Ghostbusters I'm Not Afraid with Missy Elliott.
I give them credit for trying to do their own interpretation of the song, but what really kills it is later when Missy Elliott just shows up to do a rap for no reason, and you can tell, like, either the movie studio or the label forced this to happen.
I see.
And she comes in and it's like, this makes no sense whatsoever. At least they're doing the song.
Right.
She comes in and has nothing to do with the song, movie, any of that stuff, and throws in lyrics that have nothing to do with anything going on.
I'm sick of rap being in the middle of a song. Stop.
It's forced in.
Are you DJ Snow?
Informer?
When MC Shan popped in?
This is more of the urban people to go see Ghostbusters.
They're not.
Well, that's what Hollywood does, though. They're like, all right, how do we get a little more more urbans to go see this movie? Let's get it.
You don't do it with Fall Out Boy.
That's what they do, though.
Like if you had, like,
we all know that
Waka Flocka or Fetty Wap or something doing Ghostbusters. That's how you get the urban audience into it.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
Here's the rap. She wrote that in the cab on the way over. You hear those lyrics? Jeez, these ghosts are not too good. I'm going to kill them. Yeah. I got wood.
And E-Rock gave it 7 out of 10, right?
The movie? And that's
really?
Six leaning.
That's
six
high.
Leaning on 7, yeah.
All right.
And there's some problems with it, but overall the story itself is actually good.
All right.
Like, you could see the older cast in the story.
Mm-hmm.
As much as they try to destroy that the older cast existed in this movie,
ooh,
you can see that the story is actually good.
Yeah, but the older cast signed off on it, unless they got a nice big fat payday and they said, fuck it.
Dan Aykroyd's going to say it's great no matter what, because he's the executive producer.
Of course he is.
He gets writer's credits. It's based on his properties, so you know he's not going to shit talk.
I was disappointed with Bill Murray.
What did he say?
Well, you should
be. Oh, he's in it?
No, well, just as part of the movie.
Because that's what he agreed to. He for 20 years, he turned down anything to do with Ghostbusters 3, and this is what he accepts.
Well, Harold Ramis killed himself to not be in it.
How
he died?
Yeah, no.
I forgot. So, oh, my God.
I expected more from Bill Murray if he's going to be in the new Ghostbusters.
Yeah, you expected Peter Venkman.
Yes.
We're trying not to give spoilers
Dr.
away.
Monroe, or whatever he was. He plays some weird psychological
doctor.
We're not
supposed to blow the spoilers.
It's not a spoiler.
It is.
No, it's not. It's all over the internet.
Oh.
It's okay.
Cats and dogs living together. Mass hysteria.
They did a version of that line.
Oh, yeah?
In the scene where she's talking to the mayor at the restaurant, she starts to do that line, and they cut it off.
Oh, weird.
She starts doing the whole mass hysteria buildup, and then it doesn't do the rest of the line. So there's little hints of the old movie, but then they have to purposely change it because they have to change
People
it.
People are spending way too much time
analyzing
four chicks chasing ghosts.
That's why I started by saying, as a movie, I liked it. I mean, I'm not going to go deep and go, they fucked up the original story and this and that. But we are hypocritical, or I could speak for myself, because I don't like when they redo comedies in general.
Now, it's all callbacks
to the earlier movie.
Right.
Some
people are getting way too fucking analytical about. Like, I get, like, I didn't like it for this, but I would never think of it for more than 5 seconds. Like, I get, like, I didn't like it for this. But I would never think of it for more than 5 seconds.
Yeah, no.
I don't care about the original. I don't give a fuck.
But if this was The Wire, the movie?
What's different, though? The Wire is a different movie than than Ghostbusters.
Yeah.
It's a different
thing. But Ghostbusters, I'm just saying you would analyze that if they changed everything.
I think a better example.
If Michael K. Williams was Leslie Jones.
No,
it's overrated.
Your point is not good.
Okay.
If you said maybe like if they redid The Godfather or something.
No, I'm going with something that Jimmy obsessed over.
I understand that.
Not a generalization.
But The Wire was never a movie. That was a whole long six.
Right, but the point was saying that if they made The Wire movie and they changed the cast around, kept the same names or whatever, Jimmy would analyze that as much as other people are doing it with Ghostbusters.
I would, but I don't put the Ghostbusters...
Right,
and the
it's
Wire,
not your thing.
But how could the original Ghostbusters, how can anybody look at that in the same way you look at The Godfather or The Wire?
Because
one of the biggest movies of the last 35
Absolutely.
Years.
But it wasn't even that funny. I can't remember laughing at the original
you're
Ghostbusters.
You're in the minority there.
Yes. I know.
Ghostbusters was always a silly movie, though. That's, I think, Jimmy's point.
I never give a fuck
like
about Ghostbusters. I've been saying
fine.
Ghostbusters. You give a fuck about Ghostbusters for 10 years.
Yes, I know.
I've never said
that's fine.
The original was great. I said that fucking, I got the Marshmallow Man thing at the end.
Stay Puft.
Whatever the fuck it is. I never enjoyed it. I was like, never like, this is hilarious, this movie. I was like, who cares about it? Right. I never watched it when it was on. But boom, 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 click.
That was it.
That was it. That's as far in as I got if I was on.
I watched the original recently. I don't know.
It was fine. I loved it. But I saw it as a kid, so I don't know.
As a kid,
I loved
it.
I feel like it lost a little something over the years. I don't know.
Find me one funny part of the original Ghostbusters. Find me on thing.
Oh, the Twinkie part's fun, or this man has no penis. That was fun.
This man has no dick, right?
No
Let
dick.
Me see it.
I mean, it's in the scene.
Right?
You got to really slip into it. Ray gets the blowjob from the ghost.
Right.
Power grid was shut off by...
It's so New York, it's so 80s, I love it.
Is this true?
Yes, it's true. This man has no dick.
That's
I have to see it in context. I mean,
they're in the mayor's office. It's a good time.
Yeah, it's a good time for everybody.
Yeah.
Why are we pretending like Ghostbusters 2 didn't already ruin everything?
Ghostbusters 2 didn't suck.
Eric,
no, I love Ghostbusters 2.
What?
Yeah, I know I'm in the minority, but
yeah.
I
don't think Ghostbusters 2 sucked either.
What? Come on, it's all about a painting.
Vigo.
Awesome. Oh, God, that's right.
No, I really...
They sprayed the Empire State Building with that pink jizz and then came to life. I don't know. It seemed a little much. I mean, it is about ghosts. I get it.
You mean
but
the Statue of Liberty?
What did I say?
Empire State.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they spray painted the Twin Towers. It was weird.
Yeah, Statue of Liberty comes to life in Ghostbusters, too.
Oh, how could I not like that?
Well, I mean, you know, it is. It's a movie.
Yeah, it is a movie.
Let's go to the phones here and say hi to John in Rochester. John.
Hey, OP, Jimmy, how are you guys doing?
We're doing all right,
good,
buddy.
Good, thank you, John.
Hey, how old are your kids?
6 and almost 4.
Would you take them to this movie?
It's probably still...
too scary for a 6-year-old.
It's probably still too scary.
Okay, second question is, are you looking at the movie before you got married and had kids, or are you looking through a dad going... 2.5 stars. I could take my kids to this someday and have them see it.
What do you say?
He's saying, are you looking at it as, would I be able to take my kids to this movie? Not you looking at this movie, do I enjoy it?
We have Paul Feig coming in.
Right.
So there was a screening. I said, all right, I'll go check it out. I don't know if I would have checked out this movie on my own if we didn't have Paul Feig coming in. Then I sat there. I sat next to Ron Bennington and his wife. He enjoyed the movie, too. I don't know what he said on his show, but he's like...
Yeah, I didn't hear yesterday.
He said he liked it, and he also said, wow, the audience reaction in this theater, they really enjoyed the movie.
All right.
Yeah, Kate McKinnon applause.
She's funny.
She got the biggest applause.
She was the best in the movie.
Yeah, she almost stole the whole fucking movie.
Interesting.
So that's...
Would I be able to take my kids? Well, my question is, are you looking at it through a dad, that movie now, with 2.5 stars? If you didn't have kids, would you look at it a little bit differently?
I think I just explained myself. I whether I'm a father or not, I probably wouldn't.
Okay.
I probably wouldn't have seen Ghostbusters, but because we have Paul Feig coming in, I said, all right, maybe I should see this thing to prepare myself a little bit. I would have eventually seen it, but I'm not one of these guys that had to run out and see Ghostbusters as soon as it hit the theaters.
All right, guys. Have a great day.
All right.
Ciao.
You got it, buddy. Does that make sense?
It made sense.
Okay. Yeah, maybe I'll go see it.
I was expecting a pile of shit just because of everything that's being said on Twitter and Facebook and all that. And then I was like, you know what? This isn't a bad movie at all.
There's a weird thing going on right now too, because people started out hating the movie, and then some of the reviews from screenings and premieres were coming out, and they're saying it's not as bad as everybody thinks. You know, some of the stuff is actually good, but there's still an internet group that are saying, I don't care. I don't want to see this movie. I want to purposely make it fail. So they're trying to flood like Rotten Tomatoes and those kind of sites that mean something to say how bad this movie is to purposely financially hurt the movie.
What kind of a fucking dumb cunt would say, I want to go and hurt the new Ghostbusters?
That I don't understand. If you don't like what they're doing, you don't like a female cast, whatever, then don't see the movie and leave it at that.
Well, you're throwing logic at it. This is the world we live in.
What kind
of
dumb cunt?
You get a small group of people that say, I don't like a certain thing, and now we're going to make our voices a lot louder and try to ruin it for everybody else. That's what we live in now.
Sucks.
It's like we determined we don't like this without even giving it a shot or, you know, finding out more about it. We are going to purposely ruin everything about this for promotions, for marketing, for financial reasons, whatever, because that's how I feel and my individual opinion means more than everybody else.
Yeah, if you go on IMDb, like the rating on IMDb, because that's user-based, is just like in the toilet.
Wow.
As opposed to, you know, it's got 77% on Rotten Tomatoes after almost 100 reviews.
Right. And the 77 is the critics,
that's
right?
Just critics. Yeah,
right. Yeah, because people haven't seen the movie yet.
It's very good, yeah.
But that's actually kind of a good move for them, because everybody talks about how shitty it is, quote-unquote, then you go see it and you go, actually, it's all
right. Right, but in today's age, sometimes that doesn't always work.
Right.
You're getting, like, not every piece of news is good, whether it's good or bad, so people will go and see it because everyone's saying how bad it is. People will actually not go see it.
Yeah.
Even if they were on the fence or like, I might give it a shot, but no, everything I'm reading says this is dog shit. I am not going to the movie, and now you just cost, you
know, it tricked me because I went in with low expectations, and I was like, damn, what are people talking about? This isn't a bad movie.
And that's fair, because we've all been bombarded with how bad, you know, this movie appears to be.
But that song sucks.
No, that song does suck.
Okay, yeah. Let's be in agreement there.
It does.
I understand why people don't like comedies being remade. I hate it too. But the amount of energy people online.
Yeah, it is ridiculous.
Crazy. You really, if you're online and you put, like, if you think, that stinks, they remade a comedy, I'm not going to go watch it. That's literally what I just did, is the maximum amount of energy you should put into it.
Yes.
Right.
It's horrible that people are so obsessed.
Right.
I'm fucking original.
Shut up. I know.
Fucking assholes.
Then just go watch the original movies.
Yeah.
Like,
it still exists. You know, they didn't burn that copy.
The big thing that a lot of media likes to use, they're saying, you know, these man children are saying that you ruined my childhood. I'm not saying the media is being ridiculous about it, but when people are taking that, you're ruining my childhood. That shit, I don't get.
Who said that? What person?
People say it all the time.
You'll see it on social media. You see it on websites, on Reddit, things like that. The original movies still exist.
Yes.
So don't see this one. If you're really that upset about it, don't see it. And for a while, I was on the fence. Like, I don't think I want to see this movie.
Right.
And then over time, my opinion has changed. That I was like, all right, I'm going to give it. I want it to change my mind. And it actually did when we went there for a bit. There's still some problems with it, but it changed my mind as far as the entire view of the movie.
Right.
Don't see it if you don't want to see it. Go watch the other two. They still exist. It's not like they deleted the other two, and now this is what you're stuck with.
Can I got to ask you one thing.
Yeah.
And it's a slight spoiler.
Okay.
I'm going to acknowledge that, so you got a second or two to turn off the radio. It's a slight spoiler. It's you know.
Please.
All right, go somewhere else for a second. Why didn't they move into the firehouse?
See, that I don't get, because
that's why I want to bring it up.
When they in the movie,
all of a sudden they go to the firehouse, the famous firehouse, and it's empty, and you got a real estate agent saying, "Well, the rent's going to be, what was it, $21,000 a month, I think?"
I forgot.
$21,000 a month. $21,000 a month,
and the windows don't whistle.
And then they make sort of a joke about, well, you know, we're chasing ghosts. There's no money in this, so we can't afford this. It was kind of a funny moment in the movie,
right?
And then they move. Can I say where? I guess. Does that matter?
The movie. Let people see the movie. Yeah,
yeah, let people see the movie.
That's why I'm asking. But why didn't they?
That's enough.
All right. That's why I'm asking. Yeah, so why didn't they use? What's your thoughts on that?
I don't know. We could ask him.
It was such a strange.
Comes in,
but it was such a strange
I don't know.
Moment.
I don't know if it's they kind of because there's been heat on this movie since they announced that they were even going that it got greenlit that they're going to do Ghostbusters and then it's going to be a female cast. So that's like, what, a year and a half, 2 years ago when that news came out. And people have been hating that movie since that announcement. And it's just built up until now where it's going to be released. I don't know if they added that in to appease some of the old fans at the end or if they originally had this idea of doing what Ope talked about in the script. And that was just supposed to be a nice little surprise, a nod to the original franchise. I don't know. Maybe Paul can answer that better.
Sure.
But, it didn't make sense.
I guess my point is, why not just go
the end?
Why not just go all in at that moment? You're showing the firehouse.
Well,
so.
You changed the entire cast. You changed the vehicle. You changed the villain. They changed where they're located, so they weren't using the firehouse, and that's not a spoiler. You're seeing it in the trailers that they're at above a Chinese restaurant or something like that.
Right.
And
told me not to give that away.
No,
that's what I was going to say.
Well, you already did. So
I didn't say
that
part.
In the trailer, though?
That they're in a Chinese restaurant?
Yeah, I said,
I said it's in the trailer. You see it.
No, before that, I said, can I tell everyone where they actually end up? And you said, oh, let them see the movie. Don't give that
no,
away.
No, you already said it.
I didn't say Chinese restaurant.
No, they didn't move to the Chinese restaurant.
All right. We got it.
They were at the Chinese restaurant. They moved to the place that you said.
Right. Okay.
Yeah. What it all comes down to is go see the movie or don't see the movie. It's one of the two.
that's good advice.
Then we didn't have to have the 15-minute conversation.
it's ridiculous. Either go see it or don't see it.
I think
that's where it comes down to.
Right.
If you enjoy it, great. If you didn't, hey,
this guy's got a good question.
It was an hour and a half out of your life
for Jimmy. Snowy, it looks like in Michigan. Snowy. Oh, the famous Snowy. They got you down as Snowy. Go ahead.
No, that's what I was saying. Should you take his call?
Snowy.
Hello, Snowy.
He's a regular.
Hey, great show as always, guys. Jimmy, I think I know you get the people for overanalyzing the movie, and you're right. You're not wrong, dude. I mean, some of these guys are a little overboard on their criticism of the movie. I'm not going to take it. I was never a huge fan of the first one to begin with, so, you know, whatever. But if they remade One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, I bet you'd do a little more analyzing on that one.
Interesting.
I would. I absolutely would. But the point I'm making is, who gives a fuck about the original Ghostbusters? Like, people are acting like this is some giant... Great. I know it's a culturally very relevant film, the original Ghostbusters, but I have never given a fuck about it. Ever.
I'm kind of with you. It's an okay movie. I'm a bit out of shape about them redoing it, but.
I thought the original one was fairly corny. It didn't really make me laugh. So to me, Cuckoo's Nest is a masterpiece, triple Oscar winner. And One Flew Over and Ghostbusters was just a comedy that I didn't love. I'd be much more annoyed if they remade used cars. Like, I just don't. It's the amount of venom coming out about it. But yeah, I would be much more annoyed if it was a project I loved. But the original Ghostbusters, I just never gave a fuck about. And the fact that people are trying to physically go online, they become obsessed with the fact. It's just like, oh god, who gives a fuck?
Most remakes kind of suck. I mean, Longest Yard wasn't too bad, but I still prefer the original. I mean, you know, it's...
Yeah, I didn't like that they remade that. I didn't care about it, though. Like,
right.
I love the original great example. I didn't go ballistic about the new Longest Yard. I was just like, ugh, gives a fuck.
Right.
The original one is great. They're going to make the new one. It's not going to be as edgy or whatever. That's what they do.
Yeah.
People
take
it.
Call, guys.
All right. All right.
I think they're redoing Roots. Am I wrong?
They did it already.
They did it.
It's all white people. Series.
Oh, good.
I mean, this is just the tip of the iceberg for internet hate with the movies, because you know in a few years they're going to announce at some point that they'll remake Back to the Future. Another one of those
average movie.
That won't happen.
Another average.
Oh, come
it
on.
Will
it was
at
fun.
Some point.
No, it
I
won't
know,
because
everyone loves it.
Because What's-His-Face owns the rights, and he has said that he will never do
Spielberg?
It.
Spielberg?
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Zemeckis?
Yes. Okay. He owns the rights, and he will not do it.
Yeah, but he'll die.
The studio doesn't own it.
He'll die, though, and whoever that's left to will
go to his family. But he said,
a family member will be,
he's gone on record by saying, as long as I'm alive, we won't do another
one. Oh, that's good, then. All right, never mind.
So that'll be a while. This guy wants to defend the whole ruining of the childhood.
All right.
Dennis in Philly. Go ahead, Dennis.
Hey, fellas.
Hey.
So the big thing that kind of confuses me and why I'm claiming that, don't get me wrong, there's some crazy people out there, but my defense on how it's, quote, ruining the childhood, I have kids myself, and I want to take them to see this movie. The equivalent would be like, hey, I love McDonald's, kids. Let me take you to McDonald's. You walk into McDonald's and they're selling fucking fried chicken. And you're like, well, the sign says McDonald's, but they're making fucking fried chicken. That's what they did with this new movie.
So go to Burger King.
But there's still the original McDonald's.
Yeah.
Yeah, you could still go, you could still pop in the original Ghostbusters, though, and still have that same experience.
Agreed, but my point is, don't call it Ghostbusters. They're not even in the... I won't use the spoiler that you said earlier, Hope, but it's the truth. Then don't call it Ghostbusters. Call it Broads Chasing Shit. I don't know.
That's a great porno.
Right. Broads Chasing Shit. Look, I'm very hypocritical on this because I hate when they remake comedy. So,
not Ghostbusters. That's all I'm saying, man. It's the name, and that's it all underneath. And Jimmy, how can you hate Ghostbusters?
I just never liked it. I'm not saying Ghostbusters stinks. I'm saying I don't like it. And I never really liked it.
But you like Kiss. Just give it a chance. If you can't...
I've seen the original, and because I like Kiss, doesn't mean that I laughed at Ghostbusters.
It's just hypocritical for you, man. That's all. I still like you. I'm not attacking
you. But you should also learn what hypocritical means. And it isn't because you like a certain band that you have to laugh at a comedy with ghosts in it.
Fair enough. It goes back to the childhood thing, though. You love X because of your childhood, meaning Kiss.
Has nothing to do with childhood, sir.
I don't necessarily hate your point.
It's a terrible point.
But, no, about the ruining of the childhood, but it's the level of anger that it brings out in people that I don't understand.
You know who ruined childhoods? The fucking Sandusky and Paterno ruined childhoods.
Fair point, Jim.
If your childhood is ruined by this, you literally should have pulled a fucking, you should have pulled the dresser drawers on yourself when you were a kid. And crush your own head.
Yeah, tell a victim of Jared the Subway Guy about your childhood.
Yeah, I understand being bothered by this, but the level of that people are bothered, I don't understand that. I just don't.
Yeah.
All right.
People got nothing going on.
Nope. Thank you, Dennis.
Thank you.
What are you, menace? You heard what I said?
Hurt.
That was a good one.
What did Paterno know? He just didn't want to deal with this shit, huh?
Yeah, but again, that's it. His family is saying it's not true. It's just some weird allegation. It might be bullshit.
His family is basically saying they got proof that that's not necessarily the truth. But back in 76, someone came to Joe, and Joe's like, I don't want to deal with this shit. But he basically said, I don't want to deal with this shit. I got a football season to prepare for.
Just suing. Again, the anonymous... lawsuit, an anonymous John Doe 150.
No, it was about assistant coaches.
What?
Saying that they saw.
Yeah, the assistant coaches. The assistant coaches went to Paterno and said they saw shit. Yeah. And Paterno turned around.
Why is this guy being anonymous? Who's saying this?
No, that's one of the victims. He's chosen to remain his name.
Okay, so what coach went and saw it?
Two. I don't know.
Bradley, right?
Names.
Yeah. Okay.
Bradley,
the newspaper stinks. They had a fucking little blurb about this. They didn't have all the...
No, this is it's a bigger...
It depends on what you...
No, it's... court documents say famed Penn State coach Joe Paterno was aware as far back as 76 that his top assistant was abusing boys, and years later, other coaches knew, too, including future Rutgers and NFL coach Greg Schiano. Right? In testimony about the shameful Jerry Sandusky scandal, a graduate assistant said Schiano and another up-and-coming coach, Tom Bradley, kept silent about Sandusky's crimes. The testimony came out in 2015. In his testimony, McQuarrie said he briefly discussed with Bradley what he had seen. Bradley, who is currently UCLA's defensive coordinator, was a Joe Paterno assistant from 79 to 2011 and replaced Sandusky as Penn State's defensive coordinator. Bradley was Penn State's interim head coach after Paterno was fired. All right. Bradley said he knew of some things McCreary said in his testimony. He said another assistant coach had come to him in the early 90s about a very similar situation to mine, and he said that he had someone had to come to him as far back as early as the early 80s about Jerry doing something with a boy. That reads really strangely, but that's exactly how it's
put. Yeah, but it loses all the sexiness.
McQuarrie said Bradley identified the other coach as Schiano. Bradley told McQuarrie that Schiano was white as a ghost and said he just saw Jerry doing something to a boy in the shower, and that's it.
Did they give the details?
That's all he ever told me.
What was he doing?
I never saw any abuse, nor had reason to suspect any abuse during my time at Penn State.
Were they hugging?
Schiano told ESPN's Adam Schefter.
Kissing? Oh, look at that.
Look at him showing the boy how to play football. You hold your hips here, you push it back, and you go, oh, good.
That wasn't too bad.
No, that's okay.
That is really...
That's hold just on to those hips firmly.
That's not how you put a player in the proper position. That's really
depends
weird.
Depends on the situation.
Get in a shower.
We got Paul Feig outside?
Caitlin.
Oh, we got Caitlin? All right, we'll get Caitlin on after the break. Testimony was revealed in a newly unsealed report from a risk management expert. Penn State is in a court battle to try to recoup from its insurance provider millions of dollars paid out in settlements to Sandusky's victims, so they're trying to get some of that money back. In 1976, a 14-year-old victim told Paterno that Sandusky touched him while attending a football camp at the university, penetrating his rectum with his finger as he showered.
Say that slower.
John Doe, 150, according to the newly unsealed court documents, testified that he told Paterno of the sexual assault, and the coach ignored his complaints.
Wait, what did he say he did? I didn't hear you.
Is it accurate that Coach Paterno quickly said to you, I don't want to hear about any of that kind of stuff. I have a football season to worry about.
Mm.
Specifically, yes, I was shocked, disappointed, offended. The man replied, I was insulted. I said, is that all you're going to do? You're not going to do anything else. So Paterno said, fuck this.
All right.
Jesus Christ.
Fuck this kid.
That's more of the details in the little blurb that most of the papers had.
Yeah.
So
he did it.
Huh? Sandusky?
Yeah. I'm still on the fence.
What? Are you?
No, I'm joking.
Jesus Christ.
I need more evidence.
We got Paul Feig from Ghostbusters coming in a little while. We got Caitlin stopping by to say hi. She won that gold medal in snowboarding a few years back.
Don't mention the clapper on Caitlin.
She can't. You struck out last time.
I know, but hey.
You gave it a shot last time. Remember how that all went down?
Yeah, I'm giving it another one.
You're going to give it another shot?
Sure.
And she can't snowboard anymore.
Is that right?
Oh, yeah. She's got a spinal issue.
Oh, good to know.
She falls wrong and she could be paralyzed. I forgot the name of her disease.
Uh-huh.
All right, Mark, where are you going to be?
Hey, this weekend I'm in Syracuse Funny Bone, and next weekend Providence Comedy Connection. Check the website. Then I'm in Portland, Oregon, and the Joy Theater at the end of August, early September in New Orleans, hometown. So come on out. I can't believe it.
It's a good theater.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, really good.
Oh, I can't wait.
Hometown. That's very cool. That's got to be exciting for you.
Yeah, all the weird high school jerk-off buddies are coming out.
Jimmy's going to be in Columbus next Thursday.
Yes. So check my website, and all dates are there.
Okay. And we got a giveaway from the WWE. Pair of tickets, WWE SummerSlam Heatwave Tour. For tour information, visit WWE.com/events to see when the WWE will be in your city. Winner is responsible for their own travel to and from the event. What's going on with the WWE? They can't squeeze out a couple flights.
Yeah.
What the hell is that about? I know they bought time on this this fine show, but I hate when they do that. So they're going to give you a pair of tickets, but then you have to figure out how to get there and where you're going to stay.
They have a big draft coming up.
The old days, they would take care of everything. Anyway, if you want a pair of tickets to WWE SummerSlam Heatwave Tour.
Nope. Read up top. That's the tag. You can read what we're giving away.
Wait.
Up top.
WWE ticket giveaway for July 25th Monday Night Raw show. Oh, Jesus Christ. I got this all wrong?
Well, no, you got the tag right. Like, that's what that's
they want everyone to know about SummerSlam.
Yeah, but what you're giving away is
different. Did I fuck this
sorry.
Up? Oh, wow. All right. WWE ticket giveaway for July 25th Monday Night Raw show in Pittsburgh at the Console Energy Center, right?
Correct.
All right, we'll give a pair of tickets to a random caller, but they still got to find their way to Pittsburgh, right? Yes.
So it's preferable if you live in the Pittsburgh area.
Okay, but they also want people to know about the WWE SummerSlam Heatwave
tour. To promote it, yes.
Okay, but we got tickets for Raw in Pittsburgh.
On July 25th.
On July 25th. All right, I hope that makes sense to somebody.
They're smart.
All right, the random caller gets them right now. We'll be back. And we're back.
Hey, hey.
Paul Feig is in the building.
Woo.
He's going to do a little sway, and then he's going to come across the hall and do us.
Caitlin remembers me.
Caitlin Farrington remembers Mark Norman?
What is she going to say?
That's true.
What was it? Yeah, exactly. Just be like, who are you again?
That's a good point.
I think the last time you were here, Mark happened to be in here.
Yep.
Oh, is that long?
Yep.
That was a while ago, yeah.
It was the day after I missed Anthony.
Right.
And... sad day, kind of.
Kumia?
Anthony?
Bourdain.
Oh, got it.
Oh, you're a big fan of Anthony Bourdain?
I was.
And you wanted to meet him?
And I really did, and then I blew it and missed the show.
Because you were hungover? A little too much partying?
Oh, right.
A big night.
Did you have a big night last night?
Maybe a little bit.
It kind of looks like you might have had a big night last night. Because I follow you on Instagram, and you're a little more awake on your Instagram pictures than you are right now in this studio.
You know?
What did you do?
I have my moments.
Yeah.
Well, I was part of Mappy Hour in Central Park.
What the hell is Mappy Hour?
It's so you. It's like North Face puts a scavenger hunt on.
Right.
And then you just end up. I don't know. It's like groups of eight or something.
Right.
And they start at the North Face store, and then. You just go through the park, do a workout.
Right.
Different stations, people have you. Like, we made them randomly do planks, whatever it was, and...
I'm trying to figure out if you're hungover or still fucking drunk.
I'm a little hungover. I almost could, like, throw up. Not
really?
Oh, boy.
You had a hell of a night.
You know, it escalated very fast from workouts to...
Boozing.
Really?
Sounds good.
And you don't get to New York often, so you're taking advantage of the fact.
Yeah, it's only every once in a couple months. So.
Right on, man. All right, we got Caitlin Farrington here.
I wish I met you last night.
Yeah, you guys should have ran into each other last night.
I know. Where were you at?
I was at the Comedy Cellar.
Wow. Shucks.
And then he was being a little responsible, knowing he had to do morning radio.
Yeah, I used to booze butt before this, and it was always a mistake. I wanted to kill myself every morning.
That's
yeah.
how I'm feeling right now.
How far into it before you got like, oh man, this was a bad move?
After three whiskeys, that's
no, when... no. I mean, like into the radio show, would you be half hour into it or an hour and go like, oh man, we got 3 hours to go?
Oh, no, it'd be the train ride over. Like, oh fuck, how am I gonna get out of this?
I was in the cab, just laying down. My cab driver's like. Are you okay? I'm like, yeah, it's fine. Just if I puke, don't worry about it.
Right.
Thank God it wasn't an Uber. You don't want to lay down in there.
And how's the snowboarding? You're not going back to jumping, right?
No jumping. I actually just was on Denali. Went up Denali with a group of 10 of us, and we were called Mount Baker Hardcore because the group I was with, everybody's from Bellingham area. And it was just like a group of homies, this kid, Lucas Tabari, who's on North Face with me. He was our, like, he put the whole trip together and he took his sister up about 2 years ago and she didn't make it. And she's the girl who I did the volcano tour with.
What do you mean she didn't make it?
Or she just didn't make it to the summit.
Well, I mean, usually when you talk about summits and you say, you know, so-and-so didn't make it, it means they're still up there frozen somewhere.
No.
She just didn't make the trip.
She just didn't make the full summit. So she ended up, so she wanted another girl on the trip because it was just going to be like a dude's trip. And so I got the invite.
What's the deal with Denali? How impressive is that? Like, and why?
It was the gnarliest fucking thing I've ever done. Like, and it was also like the realest thing I could say. Three people had passed away while we were up there.
Wow.
And about half the people you see are walking or are coming down with frostbite.
Holy.
And it was just like so insane. Like one day when we were heading up to 17,000 feet. We were like going to the camp and we were walking down and this guy was like, we're like, hey, how was it? Like, did you summit? Blah, blah, blah. And he was like the leader of this group. And his lips were so freaking swollen, had sores on them, were just black. And all he was like talking to me and was pretty chipper.
What's that?
And I was just, all I could do was look at his lips, and I was like, this guy, like, is he serious? How did he let this go so much? And then I found out.
Does chapstick take care of that? A little,
no.
A little chapstick, of course.
And then
not.
I found out a couple days later, one of the Rangers was telling me, he's like, yeah, we had to fly him off. He ended up, like, six of his toes had really bad frostbite. Like, most likely he was going to lose some of them. Like, and I was like, well, by the looks of his face.
Right. Think he lost his lips or no?
You know, they might have had to amputate lose their lips those too.
I bet you they lose their lips. I bet you the frostbite gets so bad you lose some of those lips.
You lose some of those lips.
Did anything happen to you? Any frostbite or anything?
I had, like, the day that we summited. So we spent 26 days up there. And the day we summited on our 20th day, and it was more so snowboarding for us too. Not, it wasn't summit or die. And I ended up the day that we were going up, I froze my feet a little bit, and Lucas had to like, it stopped, and I was like, hey, Lucas, like, I think like my right foot is pretty like frozen, because you're like sitting there kicking your feet around, trying to just like get the circulation going. And so I was like, I think my right foot, I'm a little bit worried. So we took my boots off, and he's like, okay, let's like put them on my stomach. Or cause-
Of course he said that. Yeah. Lucas is no dummy.
Yeah.
Feet on the stomach.
Let me warm them out.
Stinky
warm them up
feet
with my
that
mouth.
Haven't been washed for 20 days.
Nice.
Well, that's a turn on for some.
Yeah, it's true.
It's a lot of ways.
But, and so I ended up like taking my right foot out, putting it on his stomach, and then we're like, okay, may as well check my left foot. And I didn't feel anything. It took about an hour for feeling to get back on my left foot. And
all on his stomach, under his jacket?
Yeah, because like, that's where your body is the most body fat, so it's the most warmth, and so you kind of just like tuck him in there. And
push down a little bit, get all snug in his belly fat.
Belly fat.
Wasn't your ass cold just sitting there like this?
I mean, you're in so much gear, or sitting on your snowboard or backpack or something. So, prepared.
Why can't they make shoes or gloves that just doesn't have... Like, they have fucking stuff you can go into space with.
Touché.
True.
That's true.
With astronauts, you don't see any of fucking Buzz Aldrin going, my fingers are cold, let's get back in the ship.
Well,
a heated boot.
Well, the worst part, too, was, like, taking... I had hand warmers, and we were trying to warm him up, but the air is so thin up there that there's not enough oxygen to even warm up the hand warmer. So you're like trying to shake them. Like, usually they take only a couple seconds, but yeah. It was taking like.
I follow you on Instagram, and you got all these adventures. Who pays for all this? You have sponsors?
Sponsors.
Right? Yeah. Or.
Sponsors?
Or is there something else going on?
No, it's more so sponsors.
Because she travels the world. You're traveling the world having a good time with all this stuff.
Yeah.
How's the Pokemon up there?
That, I wouldn't have had any idea, because I just got onto that a couple days ago.
Oh, you know? I heard you were hooked.
I am. I'm a hooked Pokemon player, actually. Really fun going through the airports, because you make so many friends.
Oh, interesting.
You go find the hot spots where there's all the characters or whatever people set, and it was so funny because yesterday I was like going through the airport, and you're like standing there, and all of a sudden you look over and people are like, nice, you caught him too.
You can totally tell when others are playing it around you. It's really
so
bizarre.
Awkward. It's so funny.
And it's so stupid.
But at what point, when you're in a 26 day whatever you call it,
summit climb,
yeah, when do you want to kill yourself?
Day one.
Actually, exactly. Day two, I almost quit and was like, I can't be this person. Yep, because it was like, we flew into, because you like fly in from Talkeetna up to the glacier, and it's at 7,000 feet where they drop you off. And when we all flew in, we had about like 130 pounds each in weight that we were carrying. And so it was insane, because the second day I was like, there's no way that I can hike this mountain with this much weight. I was like, I don't even weigh that much, and there's no way I'm going to make it through. And so I was kind of like really bumming for the day and right. a half. And then I was like, I don't know if I can do this to the group. I don't want to be the person to like slow everybody down or whatever.
How much weight was it?
130 pounds.
And so you're like in your backpack, and then you have a sled that you're towing too.
Huh.
And so like the sled, it was pretty gnarly because you like the first day is like a gradual climb for about 5 miles. And we were like so excited because you're on the glacier for the first time. And you're like, yeah, this is awesome. It's beautiful. Like so many people. And then you're like talking to the people that are coming back to base camp to fly out. You're like, how was it? Blah, blah, blah. And people are like, it sucked. It was so hard. Like, and you're like, oh gosh, people are.
Yeah. And they're saying this as they're really close to the end.
As they're almost at the end. And so you're just.
Doesn't that discourage you when you're talking to a guy and he has no nose?
You're like, what happened? Up there,
just a black spot where the nose used to be.
Yeah. Fucking teeth are falling out. What'd you do? I got high up and I waved. That's worth losing all your limbs.
He's carrying his nose on his sled.
Yeah,
he's fucking, like, I think they can attach it later.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah. My wife just called me a four-toed idiot and fucking filed for divorce.
Yep. Pretty good.
But, so what happened? You, how high did you get?
Well, it's above 20,000 feet is the summit.
You got that high?
We got that high, the highest I ever been. And it was the hardest thing I've also ever done. Like, I barely remember being on the summit because I was so screwed up from the altitude.
How long were you on the summit for?
We were there for like 10 minutes.
Isn't that crazy?
Oh, that's it.
Yeah, Mount Everest is the same, but it's even less than that, I believe. You work and get to that the summit, and then you can only stay up there for just a few minutes, and then you got to start heading back immediately.
Would you do Everest if you could?
No, I think I'm leaving my high altitude stuff on Denali because
you're done with it.
I'm done with it.
Good for you.
It's more about the snowboarding for me. I like to snowboard, and the whole like hiking up to hike down doesn't make sense to me.
Silly.
Yeah.
It seems like a lot to do for 10 minutes.
Yeah.
I understand it's a tremendous accomplishment. It just seems dangerous.
Well, I tried to quit twice when we were like 500 feet from the summit. Probably.
Wow.
And I was like,
even 500 feet, you're like, fuck this.
Yep. It was just like so hard. Because I was also.
But how long does that 500 feet take? It's still a long time.
Hour more.
So what are you going straight up ice or are you walking or how is it?
Well, we skinned most of the way, split boarding. So, like, our snowboard split in half, and then they're, like, skis.
Ah.
And so you can, like, skin up or, like, walk up, hike. And so we split boarded most of the way. And then once you get to a certain elevation, you can't really skin anymore. And so then I tried to take my snowboard to the summit, but at one point I just had to cash it because I was like, I need to lose this 11 pounds and just...
You just left it behind.
Left it behind.
Did you at least throw it over the side or something?
No, I went and picked it up later, but...
Oh, yeah, you did.
Were you going to try to snowboard down from the summit?
Yep.
You are?
Yep. We're going to... But, like...
People do that?
Yeah.
How many feet? What do you go? Fucking 10,000 feet you're going?
Well, because you just go back to like 17,000.
So you'd go 3,000 feet down?
Yeah.
How do you know you're not going to just shoot off the edge of a cliff?
Right.
Well, you got to know your roots on that part. But like for us, like the day we went out of, when we snowboarded out, we snowboarded about 6,000 vertical feet.
Jesus. How big is the area you snowboard into that you know you're going to be able to stop? Like, you're coming down into an area that's kind of flat, obviously, or you would just fall off the mountain.
Not really, because, like, there's just, it's so technical up there that there's spots where you got to rope up and you got to, like, be with the group to cross like certain areas. So when you're snowboarding down from 17,000, you're just like, you're kind of following the same line that people hike up. You're right. Following the same trail mainly. And then you just like get to these fixed lines where you got to rope up or whatever.
Wait, how do you stop going down that fast?
You throw it sideways. I don't know how you stop on a snowboard.
Oh, okay. So you can stop when you're going straight down.
Yeah. You just...
You jump sideways.
Yeah, you go sideways and
But what if you fall?
What is a snowboarder's nightmare? Is it like I go to stop and I just keep sliding all the way down the mountain?
Well, I had an incident while I was up there that I had to self-arrest, which is like, I don't know, when you have an ice axe in your hand and you have to like self-arrest. And I ended up slipping as we were going along this ridge and probably slid for about like 50 feet, which was nothing in hindsight, but had to self-arrest. I probably would have gone, if I didn't, I would have gone over probably like a 1,000-foot cliff.
Who?
How far were you from the edge?
I mean, I was like 100 feet away from, but it was
scared?
It was the scariest thing I've ever done. I spent the, like, because we were hiking up still for like a few more hours, and I probably spent 3 hours like borderline tears, like just freaked out, because as soon as I self-arrested, I like ended up getting back to the trail, and everybody was like, the group was like, are you okay? And I was like, yeah, I just need to like sit down, I need to like chill for a second. But there was no place to like sit down. Like I just had to keep like going.
Keep going.
Mm. And all of a sudden I was just like, people are like, are you sure you're fine, Caitlin? And I was like, I'm just so scared right now, like scared shitless. And I was just like borderline tears for about like 3 hours. Just.
And you just couldn't stop and turn around there.
Well, you could just turn around, but it was more so, I mean, there's a group of 10 of us, so you can't just be that one that...
Why not?
You can't be that guy.
Oh, okay.
You never want to be that guy.
You never want to be that guy.
Man, that's crazy.
Anyone ever just jump off the cliff out of, I got to end this?
I got to end this. No, nobody did.
You see any dead bodies? Because Mount Everest, they use them as markers.
Well,
there's a website, I think it's called, I forgot, we've gone there a bunch of times, but anyway, the people that bring up, you know, others to the summit of Mount Everest, they know the markings. It's like, oh, we're at green ski boots guy, and they know, okay, we have this much to go, or we have to turn here, whatever the fuck it's called. There's a whole, you didn't see any.
We didn't see any.
It's probably easier to bring down the dead bodies, but Mount Everest, they said it's not like, look, here you go. There are over 200 bodies on Mount Everest and they're used as landmarks.
Damn.
And there's a guy in a red fucking ski jacket and lime yellow boots.
Ooh, what a legacy.
Yeah.
And he's just there forever. Does it say when this guy died? Because in a lot of cases, these people have been dead for a really long time, but you can't tell because it's so cold up there. It preserves everything. Yes, sir.
The guy in the green boots died in 1996.
Oh, wow. All right. So, but he's been up there 20 years. 20 years in that position. It looks like he died just yesterday.
Look at that outfit.
Right. There you go. The body of green boots. An Indian climber who died in 1996 and is believed to be, type of Indian, lies near a cave that all climbers must pass on their way to the peak. Green boots now serves as a waypoint marker that climbers use to gauge how near they are to the summit. Green boots met his end after becoming separated from his party. He sought refuge in a mountain overhang, but to no avail. He sat there shivering in the cold until he died.
I would hate that. You're fucking going up and all of a sudden you're a marker.
Yeah,
I'm just laying there, and they're like, "All right, make a left at Fat Cock."
It's crazy up there because we made really good friends with the rangers, and it was funny because like they would come and tell us these stories of people just like summit or die is everybody's like motto up there. It's crazy because we summited our 20th day after we summited. People were like, "What are you guys still doing up here? Why are you here?"
Well, you stayed after you summited.
Yeah.
Why?
See?
What'd you do?
That's what everybody else was asking. We were snowboarding.
Oh, and every day?
Because she doesn't have a real job. She gets to do, this Caitlin gets to do whatever the hell she wants.
What do you mean? I got a job.
True.
Kind of.
But it's a fun job.
What height did you stay at after you summited?
14,000 feet.
So you went back down 6,000 feet, and you snowboarded from 14,000 to what?
Well, when we left 14, we snowboarded down to 7,000.
And then you'd go back up to 14 every day?
Oh, no. You're like kind of like we would be in 14,000 feet and like we would, there's this face that you look at from camp. And so we would snowboard like over like below the Orient and just kind of, or go up the fix lines, the rescue goalie. And we
how
like
high up would you go?
Probably like 16.5.
Okay. So you, at that point, you're still in danger, but much less danger.
Yeah. It was more. Yeah.
How long does it take you to snowboard from 16.5 to 14?
Couple of seconds.
Oh, cool.
Like a minute.
That's it?
Yeah.
And then how many times a day? Sorry.
Yeah.
We do a few laps a day. It kind of depended on weather. Like,
well, if it only takes, I know what Jimmy's getting. So if it only takes a minute to get down, how long does it get take to get up so you can do the one minute of snowboarding?
Like maybe an hour or two.
Just damn. Silly.
It's like a date.
That's just silly.
An hour of bullshit for 1 minute.
There you go.
Yeah, I guess you're right.
Yeah. Wow.
So you would hike an hour or so just so you could do a minute of snowboarding.
Yep. But okay. It was.
You really love snowboarding.
Timeless snowboarding.
Intense, right?
I understand.
You had like the best views you could ever imagine.
1 minute to go.
Yeah. 1 minute.
One minute.
Is there any romance up there at all? I mean, 26 days.
Well,
did you have sex?
The funniest part is I was the hottest commodity up there because there's not very many ladies up there. So I met everybody. The group I was with was like, what the fuck, Caitlin? Why is everybody your best friend? I'm like, because I'm the only chick on this mountain,
right.
Pretty much.
Were you tempted with anybody, or did you go up there with a guy?
No.
I mean, it's a good way to warm up.
Yeah, good way to warm up.
No sex in a month?
No sex in a month.
Cool.
There you go. Yeah.
Where do people shit up there?
Well, that is one of the craziest things. We spent a month shitting in buckets and throwing it into crevasses.
Ooh.
So
one bucket you'd share?
Well, we had two buckets.
And who's crevasses?
But yeah, we had like one bucket. We'd just like dig your bathroom, build little walls for everybody.
How do you build walls?
Snow. Snow saws.
Yeah, so you're just going and sitting in a snow pit and taking a dump in a bucket?
Yeah. Pretty much.
You go down a hill for 1 minute?
That describes it all.
Wow. Jimmy doesn't like nature.
That's scary.
Yeah.
But how full would the bucket get where finally someone said, all right, come on, we got to empty this thing?
Well, I mean, once it gets...
You're not emptying after every fucking...
No.
Of course not.
No.
Just shitting on top of someone else's shit.
And can you just send the shit rolling down a hill and watch it become a snowball?
No, they have designated crevasses that you've got to go throw them in. And so, like, our first day at 14 camp, we ended up getting there, and this guy was like, this Euro guy was trying to walk through our camp with this bag of shit. We're like, no, 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 we don't come and carry our shit through your camp. Like,
yeah.
Walk around. And then, so we're like, he walks through like the crevasse, and then all of a sudden, we're like watching him, and we see him like throw his shit bag in the crevasse, and then we're like, wait a second. He just drops trout and like hoists himself in the crevasse and was like hanging on and like just took a shit, right? And we're like, when he walked back, we're like, so...
He got rid of the middleman.
We're like, does that ever like scare you? He goes, I'm on edge every time.
Oh.
We're like, oh gosh.
So wait a minute, is that a biodegradable bag?
Yeah.
It is, baby. Right?
Yes.
What a weird way to be a thrill seeker. What do you do? I jump off buildings. How about you? I shit in a crevasse.
Shit in crevasses.
Has anyone fallen into that one? I'm sure someone slid down the wrong thing and fell into the shithole.
Someone's
crevasse.
In a pile of duty for eternity.
Ice cold.
He fell right into the shit. I just want to die there. I wouldn't want
the
to
shit
tell
pile.
That story.
Yeah.
So, all right. So you're up there for a month. You're taking a dump into a bucket. What do you wipe with? Is there new toilet paper they carry up? That's a lot of paper.
Yeah. Ooh. Well, everybody, we each all took our own roll.
That's all you had, a roll?
One roll?
One roll.
Wow.
So some were just using the snow to mop up the area a little bit.
I don't know. But you ever put snow on an asshole? It ain't pleasant.
Wait, we got Paul Fee coming in.
Shit. So wait a minute. For a month, you had one roll of toilet paper and that was enough? What do you use, one sheet?
It's, you know, it's bare necessities is what you're going for up there.
So you try to be as careful.
Oh my God.
Maybe spread the cheeks a little wider to keep the mess down.
Yeah.
I'm fascinated.
I don't know what
it's all
kind
about
of
placement
you
on
guys
the bowl.
Take, right. But...
Oh, God. You kidding me?
Yeah, I know. Don't you hate when the bowl is cold? Imagine out there.
Right. It's a bucket, though.
No, the worst was one of the kids we were with couldn't poop for like 2 days, and he's like, this is really weird, you guys. I don't really know you. I'm a little constipated because I'm just embarrassed. And we're like, come on, Ryan, what do you mean? Everybody poops.
Yeah.
And then
we're all going to die up here.
And then the day that he goes to finally have his first shit, we just start heckling him because, like, you know when someone's going to the bathroom because you're sitting outside and you see him just, like,
wander off
over into the restroom. So we just, like, and then as soon as that, like, CMC is what the buckets are called, is those open, it's the worst stank ever. Oh, like, it's
wait a
so
minute.
Miserable.
So you're going into a snow hole. Can they see your head poking out or no?
If it's a good snow pit, then no. But
I would imagine, though, people don't give a fuck to that point.
Yeah.
I would. It's all cold out. You got to pull down your little fucking one piece.
Right.
Is he ready? He's sitting there. Oh, geez. All right. Caitlin Farrington is hanging with us. We got Paul Feig right outside the studio, of course, promoting Ghostbusters. He's making his way into the studio right now. Paul Feig, how are you, buddy?
Hello.
That's Caitlin Farrington. She won a gold medal at the Winter Olympics in snowboarding.
Ah, so nice to meet you. My goodness.
She can't snowboard anymore because her spine is all fucked up.
Oh, no.
So it's kind of a bummer because she wanted to maybe do it again. Yeah. Jim Norton, Mark Norman.
Oh, Jim, I get it.
And Opie. What's going on?
How's Mark? It going? Good to see you, Mark.
Nice to meet you. I think she's going to yak, honestly.
Really?
She had that yak face.
Yeah, she was partying.
Was it because of me? Did I?
Yeah.
No.
Is there a change in her?
She was climbing a mountain, and we were just talking about the shit buckets because I'm fascinated with what do you do for a month on a mountain?
Yeah.
And she was actually going through the whole process of what they do to go to the bathroom on a
really?
Mountain.
Really? Yeah. Shit bucket went in.
One roll of toilet paper.
Yeah, one roll of toilet paper.
One roll of toilet paper for about a month.
That was my stripper name back in the
shit bucket. Paul, I got to start. I saw Ghostbusters, and I absolutely enjoyed it.
Oh, you did? You didn't ruin your childhood?
Well, that's what I want to get into right away, because I'm not going to lie to you. My expectations were lowered because of all the crap that's out there.
Yeah.
And then I went and saw it. I'm like, well, let me see it for myself instead of listening to these bozos online. And I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it a lot.
So glad.
And then I was like really confused by the whole thing. Like, why are people obsessing so much about this?
Yeah. I mean, that's the thing. You just kind of go, during all this, I'm just going like, well, we just kind of made a comedy about ghosts. That we just want you to have fun in the summer. And it just became this big political thing. But I get it. Look, people are so passionate about movies they love, and especially about this one, which they all grew up with.
Yeah.
You know, so I get that. I get the trepidation. You know, when it comes down to, like, we don't want women, then that's, you guys got to go to therapy or whatever. Right. But the other people, you know, a lot of people were just legitimately concerned.
A lot of people are criticizing it. They're saying, oh, how come all the guys are dumb in it? Is it just kind of a mock of the way women have been portrayed?
You know what it is? When you make a movie, the leads of your movie are the smartest ones in the room, and they're usually faced with adversity by the people around them, the supporting cast. It's just the way you write a movie, and so it just happens when you got four women of those roles, you got guys around them, and they're either adversaries or dumb. You mean the Chris one? Look, it was just that we hired Chris, who wanted to do it, which would seem so great to have Thor be there,
yeah.
be the receptionist. And it was originally written that he was just kind of a guy that didn't really want to be there.
Yeah,
and he turned into this. Being this like amazing improv guy, and he was improvising all these jokes, but they were all kind of dopey, and it just got funny. So we just kept going on that, and who knew he was funny? It's not fair to look like that.
I know,
and actually be hilarious.
Also, it took its own turn as you were filming.
Yeah, you know, that's how I do these things. We work really hard on the script, but then once you're there, you let it kind of start finding its own thing.
You love the improv. Great.
I do,
of course you do.
Yeah, because you write something, but then when you get on that set, you got cameras, you got people, you know, it's like being in the clubs or whatever. You want to be in that moment. And that's really what it is. When two people start talking and you go like, oh, wait, it's really funny when they have this thing. And you just see how they react. Like if I'm going like, well, you know, to say the lines that right. way. And I've got funny people that I've hired. That's when it all starts to happen. And that's what is an audience. Then you go, oh, you feel like you're watching something happening for the first time. And I try to cross shoot it. So I'm shooting everybody kind of at the same time. So if they surprise each other, you get that on camera. And then it just feels natural and real.
Yeah.
Interesting. You started as a stand up or you were, I'm fascinated by how you went on a game show to get money and then did stand up.
I started doing stand up when I was 15 years old in Detroit. Oh, wow. And I had to take my parents to the club because I couldn't get in.
Okay.
And it was the most dirtbag club you've ever wanted. It was called the Delta Lady, and it was like a biker bar.
Oh, wow.
It was right in downtown Detroit. And but like Dave Coulier was starting out then, and he was around and all that. And I just kind of, I always wanted to do it. I mean, you remember Make Me Laugh, that TV show?
Oh, of course.
I don't even know if I ever watched it or just remember it by because it's iconic.
Just when I was a kid, that was the show that I think that really kicked off the sort of the stand-up.
Who's your favorite on that show?
Oh God, who was I Bruce Babyman Baum? I always thought was
Bruce Baum. Okay,
yeah, I always thought he was hilarious.
Wasn't that the show where it was ruined because I had, one of the contestants had a breathing exercise where they couldn't get the person to laugh anymore?
Oh, is that it? It could have been. I don't. I mean, I remember that it was a big show. It was hugely popular. Yeah. Then it went away all of a sudden.
The contestant would stay on until you finally made him laugh, and then someone figured out. Yeah, there it is. Okay. I think it was a woman. She figured out if I do this breathing exercise, they'll never make me laugh. And then the show was like, fuck. They're like,
oh, really?
I'm not sure if that officially ended it, but they were in a really tough spot. Cause,
oh, that's wild.
Because she figured out how to, you know.
Because one lady, they couldn't get, she just had her killed.
She's like the Ken Jennings of Make Me Laugh.
Right.
If you find the story, Iraq, but I don't want to get off the point. You came in here and said that it didn't ruin your childhood. It's funny you should say that, because right before you came in, we were talking about a guy from, where was he? Philly, I think. And he was basically saying that this, you know, the new version of Ghostbusters is ruining my childhood. I don't understand to be angry to that point.
I know it's kind of odd. I mean, again, I understand the passion and I understand not wanting to be touched, but at the same time, I don't think anything can ruin your childhood, can it? It can maybe taint something you. I don't know. I don't. That's the one thing I'm kind of mystified by.
I think it's the only thing that you can't ruin in your life is your childhood. It's your memories.
Yeah. I mean, if your childhood was bad, well, that was always ruined, and I hope you didn't have that.
Yeah, experience. Sure. Of course. When did you start realizing that you got in a little deep with this movie? You're probably sitting there going, I'm going to make Ghostbusters with a female cast with really funny women, by the way. They're all hilarious.
Yeah.
And then when did it finally start sinking in? Like, oh my God, these people are really obsessed about this.
Yeah, you know what? It happened pretty fast, because when I figured out that idea, you know, oh, if I can reboot it with these funny women, I got really excited about that, because that's, you know, that's who I work with. And then I called the studio and Amy Pascal's like, let's do it. And so I was excited. And then, so I then went on to Twitter, which I've always had such a great time on Twitter, because I've had just nothing but support and, you know, people like what I do, and wrote this thing. You know, the first tweet I put out was, you know, like, I'm going to reboot Ghostbusters with all female cast. That's who I'm going to call, and kind of put it out like, yay. And then the first day was like, yay, all these people writing back. And it was like excitement. And I'm just like, yeah, me and the internet, we're still pals. And then the second day, it just goes into the shitter.
Wow.
It's like, and you're like, oh my God, like just the most vilest.
That was your first internet reaming? Was the
It really was. I kind of avoided it. I had a few kind
Welcome to the club.
I know, man. I'm in deep now. I'm never getting out of it.
They broke your cherry.
Kumbaya is gone forever. Yeah.
Oh, but you were certainly surprised. Like, oh wow, okay.
Well, it's a bummer. Yeah, but you know. But I don't know. I learned valuable lessons from that, because you do have to take it very seriously when you're restarting something that is so classic. You know, it's like literally doing the Godfather, a new version of the Godfather for a lot of people. But, you know, just kind of focuses you and makes you go, okay, well, here's the things we got to do. And I think, because that happened even before we wrote it. So then it was like, okay, well, let's make sure that we don't make mistakes. But we, you know, we're all such enormous fans of the original movie that's why we kind of go like, no, guys, we're not against you. It's not like I'm going in like, fuck that movie. I'm going to, you know, make whatever I want.
And most of the original cast does cameos in this. Yeah. You would think that would calm some people down. Like, look, the people that were in the original movies, they're fine with this. They're in it.
Yeah.
But that doesn't even matter to some of these people.
Well, among the hardest core of haters, literally, you go like, man, we can't do anything right. Because the minute I've watched some of these hardcore haters who claim to be these enormous fans of it turn on every single one of these cast members when they come on board. It's like, well, he sold out. Fuck you. Blah, 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 you know,
sold out. What do you mean? Like, well, he's not the guy who made the first movie about the little monsters in the city. What the fuck is wrong with people?
It's so bananas, and to the point where there's this whole conspiracy thing going on about that Bill Murray, because there was some memo that came out during the hack about how Sony was thinking of possibly trying to get legal action to try to make Bill Murray be in a Ghostbusters remake. You know. Not remake, like sequel, which if you ever met Bill Murray or know anything about Bill Murray, good luck trying to lawsuit him into doing anything. And it was also came out before our movie was even existed. But now this is the whole thing of like they feel that somehow he was litigated into having to support our movie, which, again, if you meet Bill, good luck doing that.
Right. He's not that kind of convincing.
No, no. I think Bill would light a cigar with the injunction you give him.
People get weird with comedy remakes because they think people make them politically correct. Like, when they redid Bad News Bears, they took out so many things. And that was my only issue, because I love Billy Bob Thornton.
Yeah.
But it's like when they try to make it polite and they take out some of the things that, like, were punching you in the stomach in 1975.
Yeah.
Whatever it was. Mm-hmm. That's a great bother.
Yeah. I mean, you know, people do think there's, like, I have a feminist agenda, which, again, I just went to the funniest people I know. I work with funny women. I love working with funny women. And it just felt like this is the way to do it. This is the way I know how to do it. Sure. If somebody else had done it, that's fine.
And you know most of these women from Bridesmaids, so.
Yeah.
You know they can perform.
Krista and Melissa just are just comedy gods.
Right.
You know? And then, my God, Leslie Jones, holy shit.
She's hilarious.
She's so fucking funny.
Yeah.
And then Kate McKinnon's just
she almost
bananas.
Stole the whole movie, you know.
It's crazy.
At the screening I went to, she got the biggest applause. They applauded everybody when the credits rolled, but she got the biggest
Kate
one.
Kate or Leslie, which one?
Kate.
Oh, yeah. No, Kate, people love her character. I mean, there's so much fan art on the internet every day. People like have really latched onto her and her look. It's awesome because she's the sweetest person in the world.
Can I ask you about Rick Moranis? You had a tough time getting him? Or?
He was the only one that didn't want to do it, and I totally get it. I mean, look, he hasn't done anything in a long time, and I think he's looking to come back, but this was like a one, you know, it's like a two-line cameo, because I didn't want any of the cameos to overwhelm the cast, because I want my cast to be able to be the stars, but I just wanted to have these nods where you're like, oh, you know, we're just kind of giving you an Easter egg, and Rick wasn't into it, which is a bummer, because I love him.
I got a beating, because the next day I came in here and I said, seeing the cameos pop up was a lot of fun to see.
Yeah.
I did have fun, though,
because
it did bring me back in time, like, oh, there, you know, he's popping up as this character or whatever. And,
yeah.
I probably enjoyed it a little too much, maybe. I don't know.
That's all right. Nothing wrong with that.
Right.
Does it feel like great revenge that everybody was so much hate, and then the movie comes out, it's pretty good. Everybody seems to like it.
You know, I'm not a vengeful guy. I'm just more relieved because I just want something to have its day in court. You know, if you see it and you don't like it, that's great. But like, you know, I can't, it's been months and months of people going like, your movie sucks. It's like, well, you didn't see it.
Right, right.
You know, any of the trailers or whatever, people have trouble with the trailers, but I don't make movies to make trailers.
Do you have a say when the trailers, putting the trailers together, or is that independent?
They pass it by me, they show me stuff. Okay. And I can weigh in on it, but the ultimate decision is not with me.
Right.
Yeah.
The only thing I didn't like about Ghostbusters is the song. I didn't like the song.
Which one? The new one?
The Fall Out Boys.
Well,
didn't like it.
There you go.
I just got to be honest.
Did you like the Missy Elliott part?
I enjoy Missy Elliott in general.
There
but
you
see,
because
people out there are like, you're selling out, and when he comes in here, you're going to kiss his ass. No, I really enjoyed the movie.
Come at me, man.
I didn't like the Fall Out Boys.
No, that's cool. I mean, what people.
I might be too old, though, to get
Fall Out
cool.
Boys.
But
here's the thing, people think it's our main theme, and as you can reveal this, we actually use the original song
in
the movie. So you're not coming in going like, here's Fall Out Boy.
Is there a few different versions of the song?
Yeah, yeah. Because in the end credits, there's a like a punk rock version that is a band of three women who are school teachers who are unsigned. And they sent us this cover that was so awesome. I was like, I got to put this in the movie.
No kidding.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
No, so you made them stars.
Yeah. They're called, shit. God damn it. No Small Children.
No Small Children.
Terrible.
Yeah. We'll rename them.
Now, I mean, my review on this is easy because I'm not like in that geek culture. Eric in the corner, E-Rock, he does a whole show on geek culture and all that. He really enjoyed the movie too, and he was kind of surprised as well.
Yeah. I started when the announcement, like maybe 2 years ago, when you they're going to do the movie and then the female cast, and like a lot of people, I was like, it just seemed like you're changing it just because you could change it, not that you should change it.
Right.
And Christ. Then as things were moving on, I can understand why people were getting upset, and based on what you just said, that you didn't do the movie trailers, I don't honestly think some of the trailers that came out are promoting your movie the right way. Mm-hmm. Because when we went to go see it, there were some things that were a bit of a pleasant surprise. Like, I don't think Leslie Jones is portrayed the best in the trailer as she comes out in the movie.
Yeah.
And I understand why people are like, oh, she's just being a stereotypical obnoxious black woman in the trailer. But when you see the context and how it's being used in the movie, you're like, okay, she's not really doing that.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, the trailer, my movies, I always have a hard time trailering because now that you've seen what I do, yeah. It's all about context. And these, I don't do kind of like snappy jokes and all that. But what happens when they put a trailer together? You know, we do these test screenings the whole time we're putting a movie together to see how the movie's working, and we're swapping out jokes. And you know, we work it kind of like as you're working a stand-up routine for over the course of months and months.
And that's not the way I do. I just do it once and it's organic.
Yeah, well, yeah, I know. I mean, exception to the rule. But so what they do is, you know, there's things that just destroy in a test screening,
right?
And so they go, oh, let's grab all those things and put it in, but they're out of context. And so, you know, like her when she hits the ground, like, I don't know if it's a race thing or yeah. anything that destroys in a theater, but in a trailer it's just
because you see what builds up to it and how she acts after it, but yeah. you just kind of cherry pick that line.
Yeah.
It gives you the wrong impression of what her character really is in the movie.
But that's why it's so hard to, I mean, it's honestly so hard to trailer any comedy, unless it's just like a snappy, I don't know, it's the weirdest thing. It's comedy's all about context.
And also with the trailer, the first trailer that came out said 30 years ago, yeah. these guys did it, and now... This was everybody's first look, and you're seeing everything, and people found out, well, it has nothing to do with the original series. You're yeah. saying, that happened, but this didn't really happen where we're doing. So I think that's another point where a lot of people got mad, saying, well, you're yeah. referencing the original series, but you're saying now in the story it didn't exist.
Yeah, I 100% agree with you on that. There was research that showed people needed to know what we were trying to do. Is it a sequel? Is it not a sequel? And that was the wording that was come up with in a way... From the studio's point of view, I know it was more to say, like, look, we're not pretending that the other movie didn't exist at all ever, but it's that hard balance. You go like, but we're not saying that this is part
right.
of it. So it was confusing. It,
for people's first look, I think that's yeah. offset a lot of people because it would look like you're saying, well, yeah, but we don't care about the original.
Yeah.
And that's, again, it gave the wrong impression for what your movie actually is doing.
100% agree with that. Here's the crazy thing about showbiz and how we do these things is they... You know, they test all those trailers. They, you know, do actual testing with them. And that tested really high. So every time even I was kind of like, I don't know, it seems confusing. It's like, look at these numbers. People love it. So then you're like, well, okay. And it's just hard to say, really, because right. even I would see that play in theaters and it would work really well. So there's just no way to know. I hate the marketing of I just it makes me my stomach go into a knot because I also don't want to give anything away in the trailers. You know, you have to give stuff away. I love.
Why do you though?
Because yeah. they just have to show something.
But what about when you're sitting there and they give the entire movie
away? Well,
that's
the worst. Yeah. Those are the worst.
And it's way more important than a comedy.
Yeah.
And there's an extreme plot twist, and they're giving it away in the trailer, and yeah. they're like, oh, now I know this character obviously survives pretty much to the end
and
of the movie.
Some trailers have the endings that you don't even realize.
It's yeah. ridiculous.
Well, you know, because I've had heated discussions with people in the industry about this. There are kind of two schools of thought on trailers, and there's one school of thought is which you just show a mini version of the movie to the audience, and the other is just, you know, find something to entice them in.
Yeah.
I personally hate the thing where you go like, oh, I just saw the whole movie. Why do I need to go now?
It drives me nuts.
Before yeah. I go to movies, I don't watch any of the trailers.
See, I wish everybody was like
that. I just go, if people are like, what's that movie about? I'm like, I have no idea, but I'm going.
Yeah,
it's so fun.
And the problem is now, on top of that, because of the internet, everybody wants an exclusive clip. This, so like suddenly you go like, oh my god! Like I think my whole movie is if you really looked around on the internet, you could piece together the whole movie.
Everybody wants an exclusive clip.
Yeah,
we got four cameras here and go.
Here we go. Exactly. I'm gonna strip. Here it comes. Nude fig. That's the clip you get.
And go.
The clip nobody wanted.
Do you think like test groups hurt the movies in a way because like or focus groups because they change so many things for a small group and they kind of take away the vision or they'll change the vision of the writers or the directors or the people who really know what funny is?
Well, it's I'm suspicious of focus groups for marketing materials, but I'm very slavish to test screenings that we do because again it's like working stand-up. I mean, we get, you know, generally like 300 or 400 people recruited off the street and we bring them in and show them the movie. And what I've found over the years is that it's the same reason why you can kind of call an election after 1% of the precincts right. are in. If you got a big enough group that's been really just randomly picked, it's pretty representative.
Okay.
Yeah. But what I will, if things that I really love won't work in one time, I'll give them at least one or two more shots. But then when they don't work with another group, then you go like, wow, this is really just
yeah,
nuts.
I guess that is like, yeah, that makes sense, where you're actually getting the feedback of people, and if they're not laughing or if they don't like it, well, that's, you're making it for people to like
yeah,
it.
Yeah, right. That's why you have to get a very random sampling.
And what do they do? How do you know what are they have a button or something that they're pushing, or how are they letting you know each time?
No, all we do is we record their laugh, so we just have recording devices, and then they fill out a questionnaire at the end, and they'll mark scores. Those I don't care about. All I care about is that laugh track, because then my editor and I, we put it back in, yeah, go into the editing room, and yeah, as you're going like, well, did that get a laugh? Let's listen. And then, you can't fight that.
So you're in on the whole editing process too.
Oh my God, that's all I do. Yeah, I mean, you do. I mean, that to me is the more important even than production. Production's just where you just get everything. Okay.
Is it tough to cut scenes that were hilarious but don't work in the movie for whatever reason, or that it went too long and you got to cut something?
Yeah, you kill babies all the time. Kill your babies.
Does it drive you nuts?
It does drive me nuts. It used to be worse, because in the days before DVDs and when you could stream all this extra material, it was just like, if I don't put it in the movie, it's gone and forever. No one's ever going to see it. But now that you go like, oh, we'll put in the extra materials, it makes it so much easier to get rid of it.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
You said Chris was improvising a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Do you ever have people who improvise where you go, Jesus Christ, will you just stick to script? You're terrible.
Well, if they're a bad improviser, yes. But no, I that's one of the things I kind of vet when I hire people, is to make sure they can do that. Obviously, Chris Hemsworth, you're like, okay, we'll take Chris no matter what he can do. But that's why it was such an amazing gift. We go, wow, he's actually good at this. But I'll let people do it. If you can get, I can get people improv who aren't even, that's not their skill set. If I can just get them in character and get them to not try to be funny.
Right.
So if they're just kind of being the person and they're working with somebody who's good at improv, then you can almost kind of pull it out of them if they just commit to acting naturally.
Yeah, because I was in Trainwreck and Judd was like, just go, just play around. And he was like, stop playing around. And I got cut out.
Mark. Oh, no.
Yeah.
Stop playing around. One little spoiler that we discussed before you got here, and to give the people a couple seconds to turn off the radio.
Sure.
The firehouse. It drove me nuts. Like, you showed it. They were in it.
Yeah.
Was there something deeper than that, or just... That was just your angle on
it? Was it added in?
Oh, no. It was always in the script. It was just the idea that... they got to set up headquarters. Like, here it is. It was sort of a meta way to go like, oh, there's the firehouse. Oh, they have to earn the firehouse is basically what it was. I mean, that to me and Katie, that's really what it was.
Yeah, it
all
felt
about
a little deeper than this is how we're getting. It felt like there was a little more to it.
Well, that's why. Yeah. Why did the end?
Spoiler alert. Yeah, exactly. Okay. Gotcha.
Yeah.
Because that was pretty. There's a lot of cool little moments in this film.
You just want to do nods. I mean, again, we're just such giant fans of the movie. And really, when we sat down to write it, we go like, well, what would we be bummed out if somebody else made this movie and we had to see it that wasn't in it?
Right.
You go like, I want to see the Ecto-1, and I want to see Proton Packs, and I want to see Slimer, I'd like to see the Firehouse.
And a little scarier.
Yeah, well,
this movie's a little scarier.
Thanks. Yeah, I wanted to be really scary. You have to, we can only make it so scary because we wanted to be able to have everybody go see it.
Yeah.
But it's not a kid's movie, but it's, you want it so people can bring kids if they want.
And then the special effects certainly add to it.
It seems like everything's darker now. Like Batman is way darker.
Yeah.
Like James Bond is way darker. Everything goes for a little more edge these days.
Yeah, but that's why we wanted to keep this still fun, That's what I like about our movie is it's not heavy like some of those other ones, which I love Batman and Superman and all that, but this one's just there to have a good time with.
Yeah.
And if you see it in 3D, it's awesome.
I was talking about the special effects, the way you guys did the ghosts in this movie. There was it taken from, they put out a video game that Dan Aykroyd wrote and everything a few years ago, and it looks the same, very like vivid electric looking,
right,
as compared to being dull in the original movies like that. Did you get that off the video game?
No, weirdly not. I mean, I knew the video game and it probably was in my head, but it really came from the fact that our villain, he's bringing back ghosts by energizing them with these devices he creates. But then we also wanted to, I like to do as much in camera as I can, so it's not just my actors acting with tennis balls and that kind of thing. And so it said, I want to actually cast the ghosts. I want to use actors I know. Mm. So we put, like the one, Gertrude Aldridge, the one who spits ectoplasm all over Kristen in the trailer. That's an actress I worked with, Bess Rouse, who was on this show I did for Yahoo called Other Space. And we put her in full costume, full makeup, everything. But then we put this, like, LED light suit, kind of, which is just, it's just these strips of LED lights. But what it does is it throws light onto the actors and onto the environment so that you don't have a ghost that doesn't kind of interact that way. And those lights were so kind of bright, we could tone them down visually in with the effects wise, but we kind of liked the way it looked, and it just suddenly started to feel like the look of our movie to have these more energized, and it just made it kind of more fun to watch. So we just started to go with it.
And the other thing with the effects is when this isn't a spoiler, it's in the trailer. Yeah. Rowan is the giant ghost,
yeah,
which people thought was Stay Puft in one of the teasers.
Yes,
but the way he looks like, Rowan? Is it based on is that based on looking like Dan Aykroyd?
No. So many people have said that. Yeah, it's like, poor Dan.
Looks like him, like in Nothing But Trouble. Like that.
Oh my God, that's really good
observation. You know what it's really based on is, another spoiler alert. Turn off your radio. No, not Trump. No, it's the logo.
Oh, yeah,
exactly.
But just the way the eyes, the nose, and that sneer kind of look like Dan Aykroyd. I was just wondering.
I'll let you ask Dan about that.
All right. I think all this movie nerd talk, Caitlin's hymen actually grew back.
I came back.
Are we too nerding it out or anything?
No.
Do you have a question? Did you see the original Ghostbusters?
Yeah.
Did you like?
Yes.
Yeah.
Did I haven't seen the new one.
More importantly, did you run off to go pew? Right.
I did.
I told you.
Mark knows.
I know the lady's puking.
Oh,
Mark
my goodness.
Oh. I can call it. I've had a lot of girls puke around me.
Must be your looks.
Yeah. You haven't seen me naked.
Hey, right outside the door, you
did? Yeah, we had to run her out.
I had to run out.
Oh, my God.
That's so far.
There was a trash can there. I made it to the trash can, and then I made it to the bathroom.
You poor thing.
You look better.
You okay?
Yeah, a little self-inflicted pain.
Oh, I did hear about this.
Yeah. She's a cutter.
But it's not good for it's not good for Paul Feig. As soon as he came in, you ran out.
I know. I'm very insulted.
And puked.
I'm amazed that you've recovered like this. The few times I've thrown up, it's like, that's it. I'm done for 24 hours.
It's all about that puking rally.
There you go. You boot and reboot.
Yeah. You only puked a few times? You only puked a few times?
Yeah, I hate the experience of throwing up so much, and I will do anything to not throw up.
There are people that do that. Like what's a trick you'll use? Because me, I'm fingers down the throat, get rid of it guy.
Really?
I hate it so much that I wonder I can just stand and puke into the toilet if I have to, because it makes you feel better.
Wow, that's amazing.
How do you stop yourself when you're really, really sick?
I just
sick?
Go into this kind of like, don't, just kind of sit quietly and like, but then sometimes I'm like, but I'm just letting poisonous food go through my body. But
you feel worse, right?
When I've thrown up, my stomach hurts so much, like for days. It's like something.
Oh, really?
Good ab workout, though, man. It feels great. Yeah, it looks good.
You
look really good.
We didn't know this about you, Jim.
You don't get that thing where you're on your knees and your chest hurts and you know it's coming, you're sweating, you're tearing up.
That's why fingers down the throat. I'm like, let's fucking cut it out. It's the anticipation. Go through it, knock it out.
Man.
And the more they... I hate it, but I mean, when it's done, it's done.
I might.
Get out of here.
There she goes again.
She
really did.
You can't boot in front of Paul Feig.
This
is...
Why not? He's rebooting, she's booting.
God, see, Paul, it's so hard to work with women.
A good thick vomiting.
She's paddling.
Oh, God.
This poor thing.
It's all Schweppes. A good vomiting. Hold on. What do you take her out for? You let her puke in the garbage.
She was doing fine.
You've seen it here.
Paul's not going to forget about it anytime soon.
Oh, man.
I would not be happier about
this. That's what she thinks of your movie.
That's right. Oh, yeah. The haters are going to have a field day with this one.
The joke's on her. She's just pregnant.
God, I hope we have that on video, because the haters will be like, see?
Oh, my God. That was, I feel terrible for her, but also that was.
Oh, I'm so happy we did that to her.
Wow. Power booting inside the studio.
Yeah. And it was all green.
What do we talk about next week?
That was green slime, too. Yeah, see, there's the tie-in.
You
could use that.
I hate her a lot.
You could
do
use
that
today. Paul Feig, pleasure meeting you, first of all.
Oh, you too.
You've made some great movies over the years. And I got to say, I liked the movie a lot.
I like that. I'm very pleased.
And I did have low expectations because I got dragged into this whole thing. Yeah. It was everywhere for a while. And then I'm like, I'll see it myself. And it was funny. And I liked it a lot.
You know what? All I ask anybody is just be open-minded. So I appreciate that. Thank you so much.
That's a lot to ask these people these days.
I know, man. God forbid.
They'd rather just follow some other shit.
I know. Well, it's not like there's other important stuff going on this year.
Trump?
What? Who? I directed Trump.
What?
I directed Trump in these spots. I did these internet spots for Macy's back in 2010. And his was about him. It was about like these celebrities showing up and giving a makeover to somebody or whatever. And it was, but they were funny. It was Trump going to a kid's bake sale at a high school and then, or no, at an elementary school and then helping this one little kid be better at it. And it was very funny. So, but that was my only, encounter with Trump.
They're saying we got to wrap up.
There we go.
Thank you, Paul.
Thanks, Paul.
Thanks, you guys.
Ghostbusters
so nice
in theaters this Friday, finally. Go That's see it. It for yourself, and then judge all you want after that, I guess.
Yeah, do whatever you want.
That is the American
way. If you can avoid letting me know how much you hate it, that would be okay. But let me know if you like it.
All right.
Thanks, guys.
We'll take a quick break, and we'll be back. Stay there.
I can go blow up.
Black Keys. Mark Norman. Caitlin Farrington, that needed to happen, I was telling her.
Oh, yeah. I'm impressed you came in. What an animal.
I had to bring it up. When you came in here, you looked so fucking bent. I'm like, I can't let this go. I'm like, she's either still really drunk or extremely hungover. And if you're tuning in, then we had Paul Feig in, and he's getting a lot of hate over the Ghostbuster movie and all that. And then, perfectly, Caitlin Farrington gets up from her spot and just starts power booting into the garbage pail in the studio.
Oh,
sometimes
yeah.
You just got to boot and rally. Makes you feel that much better.
During the break, I walked out. I went, that's why I love radio.
Yeah.
You got, like, the Ghostbusters director in here, and then you got Caitlin Farrington, who won a gold medal at the Olympics, power booting in the garbage. Where else are you going to get that shit?
That's a beauty. I've never been more turned on. That was amazing. So impressed with you.
But that definitely needed to happen, because you look way better now.
I'm feeling way better
You
now.
Look way better.
I know. At the beginning of the time, I'm not going to lie, I was having those moments of, like, almost puking, and I was like, no, I got this.
Yeah. It's funny how the shit talk for 20 minutes did nothing to you.
But
that was fun.
As soon as the puke talk comes up.
Yeah.
Right. But then you think about it, you live on a base camp for 26 days in the snow. You can handle a little hangover, you know?
Yeah.
You've done way worse.
Yeah.
I think we might have an angle on that, too. So I think we might have a video today, Paul. I think we might have a video of Caitlin puking because she can't stand Ghostbusters. That's what it's gonna be. That's right. What the video is gonna be labeled.
It'll go viral.
Four female leads. I'm gonna be sick.
Right. Oh, and it was green. It was perfect.
And how cool was Paul? Tie-in.
He was awesome.
He's like in a four-piece fucking suit, and he's just like, oh my god, that poor thing.
Yeah, there was a time he wanted to be Woody Allen.
Is that right?
Yeah, so it's and he dresses sort of like has that vibe about him,
yeah.
Right? Yeah, he wanted to be Woody Allen. He wanted to direct and be in all his own films and stuff, so.
Well, it's never
we didn't get to that point.
Never too late to meet a young Asian.
Sure. E-Rock, what do you think? What are you laughing at?
You ruining people's photos.
I'm not the only one. Why are you pointing me out when everyone else was
doing it? Mark tried, but he was behind everybody directly, so right. Only yours is showing up.
How did I ruin your photo?
Let's see. You're shoving your finger up your nose right on my shoulder as I'm standing with Paul Feig.
Wait, let me see. You can cut that out.
Let me see how it came out. Sometimes I try to do it in a way where you can crop this shit out. Yeah, you're not going to be able to crop that one out.
Let me see.
Yeah, that one's not going
to be. Oh, yeah, you're fucked.
I'm digging fucking deep.
Oh, yeah.
Digging fucking deep.
There digging for gold there.
Yeah. What are you going to do?
Yeah, Feig, what a guy. I really liked him.
Great guy.
What'd you think, E-Rock?
I thought it was great. He was very... he was very prepared for all the hate that he's been getting for this movie for the last 2 years, and he had an answer for everything, and it made sense.
Right.
It wasn't that he was just deflecting or saying that
people
don't know what you're talking about, whatever. He's like, no, I get it, and then had a reasonable explanation for everything.
And I told him the new Ghostbusters song sucks. I did tell him that. Yeah,
well, that is true. The Fall Out Boy song does suck. All but right. The other versions are good.
The punk version
at the end, there's a group called Walk the Moon who had that song Shut Up and Dance, which was a huge hit for like the last year or two. They did a version of the theme that's on the soundtrack and in the movie, and that one's good as well.
All right.
Very, very cool.
And then they play some DeBarge.
Oh, shit.
You're giving away more spoilers than me.
It's on the soundtrack.
I think I did.
It's on the
oh, all right.
It's just online. Right. It's totally good.
I think I did pretty well. There was a time I couldn't help myself. I had to spoil all movies.
Yeah.
But then the problem is they want you to see these movies before they come in, and it's so hard not to talk about what you just saw.
Right.
Right.
So,
but the trailers do it for you now. Like you brought up that a lot of these movies now put
the big reveals or the endings in the trailer before you realize that's what it is, and you see the movie and you go, the trailer already ruined it for me and I had no idea.
Right.
Batman vs. Superman had it. Terminator Genesis had it.
Right.
And that's the big thing now, is you got to put everything in there to spoil it, or else they think no one's going to come and see a movie anymore.
Yeah. We're just reliving Caitlin Farrington just power booting into the garbage.
Yeah.
In front of the Paul Feig, who's getting so much hate over his Ghostbusters movie. It was perfect.
Yeah.
It was perfect.
Nice guy. I don't think I've ever met him before.
He was awesome.
Great guy.
Really down to earth.
Very dapper.
Yeah. Smelled good.
Mm-hmm.
Would you do the Ghostbusters sequel that they might do after this, Jim, if he asks you?
What kind of question is that?
Well, you're disgust for Ghostbusters. I didn't know if you would.
Of course he would do it.
I'd fucking. Of course I would do it.
He would kick Dan Aykroyd right in the balls. Oh, get out of my fucking way.
I would do
this. Is my role now.
I'd remake any movie if they offered it to me.
My movie.
No matter how horrid it was, the new remake of The Exorcist. You know, where I'm the guy. Go away, Dev. You know.
At Birth. At Birth of a Nation.
At Birth of a Nation.
And Paul Feig recognized Jimmy, so that was
yeah.
Great. Yes.
Yes.
They were sizing you up for a future part.
He certainly was. They all do for 5 minutes. And then they realize what a terrible mistake that made.
But Caitlin's looking much better.
Yes.
I made it.
Yeah,
I'm feeling better, you guys.
Yeah, the Thanks. Thing is, when you start to feel that stomach rumbling.
It was you talking about your fingers down your throat that got me.
I hate doing it. It's like, but my mouth gets very watery, and I take the middle and the pointer finger all the way down the back until my knuckle, like, it's almost like my fingers are against.
I'm going to puke. Like you're
digging for a G-spot?
My thumb is against my chin, and I literally hook my fingers down beyond the back of my tongue, and you start pushing your tongue in.
This sounds terrible.
I do.
You just have to touch that little ball in the middle of your throat.
Just give it a little.
Yes. Flick. I'm with Jimmy. I'm like, let's get this fucking thing over with. So if I got the headache and I got the, I'll start jumping up and down and doing whatever it takes to really shake up my body so I can puke.
Oh my God.
I just fingers down the throat.
Get it over with.
Horrible. And it's done. The worst is in the beginning when it's very thick and there's everything that
you've
eaten.
Have you ever puked a bagel and cream cheese?
Mm. No, I've never actually recreated something, but I mean,
that one's terrible.
I puked a small balloon animal once at a kid's party.
Is there anything better than when you continue to puke and now it's brown and it could barely fill up a teaspoon? Anyone?
Just dry heaving.
Oh, you're still squeezing something out of your gut.
All right.
I believe that would be the bile that they talk about, right?
The worst feeling.
The bile.
It's like that worst is that fucking.
Are you guys big sour beer fans?
No.
Okay, good, because that's exactly what sour beer reminds me of, is bile. I'm puking.
I tried it on E-Rock's beer show.
You're thinking about it now.
I've never heard of that.
I tried it on E-Rock's beer show. I didn't like the sour beer.
Yeah. I know this guy who would eat puke. This guy, Wayno Drano, he was a maniac. He was a quiz gym one of Florentine's friends. He was funny, but he was crazy. He would actually eat puke. He would eat people's puke.
Like a baby bird.
As a goof, yeah.
Yuck.
Like, what about a Vesta puke he made one time was sliding in someone's backyard. Florentine knows Wayno the best.
Let's not forget about Pat Duffy. We gotta nod our head to Pat Duffy, who had no problem eating other people's puke over the years. Here's the make me laugh. Is this the contestant, right?
Yeah, she does these breathing exercises.
Yeah, just for reference, because it came up during the Paul Feig interview.
And you'll notice a young Gary Shandling and Gallagher.
Oh, sweet.
This ruined the show. I thought it ruined it. I don't know how this ended, but they didn't know how to get rid of this lady, because she just figured out
how that's how it worked from week to week, to be the same lady person or whatever?
You would stay in that chair until someone finally made you laugh, so you would come back for, you know, different shows.
How long was she on for?
I forgot. It's over 4.5 minutes.
It just popped into my head today. I forgot all about this. This was in the 80s, I think.
Now, how long was she on the? Oh, you'd only be on for one episode, though, right?
No.
They bring you back till you laugh.
Yeah.
So how many episodes?
Till you laugh.
That's what I asked during the break to get the backstory on this, because it is a fascinating story.
I think she was just on this episode, and because none of them can make her laugh, they're saying in the description here that she got a big standing ovation from the audience.
Oh, man, I remember a different story. I'm going to have to do some research after the fact.
But this is the lady who has the breathing.
Yeah, all right, play this.
I would never laugh at this shit.
That's what I was thinking. Also, what if you're autistic?
Oh, that's horrible audio.
You were doing Lamar's. I don't believe it. Am I right? That's, all right, listen, here comes Gary Shandling. Good luck to you.
All right, Shandling.
It's hard to hear, though.
Look at a young Gary Shandling in his bell bottoms.
Could you hold on a second? I have four tires I want blown up.
This is official.
So he got her hooked up. Oh, it's Ed Sullivan. Or, you know, I'm not going to laugh if you're not going to laugh.
I've got to do my own breathing exercises to make it through.
Yeah, the audio's too. It's, yeah, the audio's
that's
too.
The only copy.
He looks like Seinfeld there. It was actually very funny.
Yeah, she's just doing breathing exercises like she's giving birth to a baby. And whatever. Gary Shandling looks terrific.
I feel like I could do this in a second.
Yeah. Okay, is it Charlie? Eyes? Who's that in the middle?
I don't know.
That's a young Gallagher, though.
Is
wow.
that the guy from Welcome Back, Kotter?
The kid? Horshack.
Ron. Oh, she was actually laughing during the, when they were done, though.
Yeah.
Like, she was holding it and actually really laughing. Okay, so she was just having fun.
She made it.
Well, that thing around her neck, by the way, I hope that got fucking caught in something and her head got ripped off.
In the ceiling fan or something.
Yeah, or in the fucking, like, I heard about some lady with a long scarf that got caught in a tire of a car she was in a convertible, and her head came right off.
Oh, my
Yay.
God.
Yay.
Oh, Gallagher's got a whole countertop of props.
You hear about the lady in the Grand Canyon?
Yeah, she's...
I think she was one of the big, I hate saying it, but I'm going to, one of the big wigs at Yelp.
Oh, wait, right.
She moved out of the way to let some guy pass on one of the trails. You ever do the Grand Canyon? Have you ever hiked down to the river?
No.
That's something you should do. That's that's an amazing thing.
Colleen Burns, she was 35 down. And hiking. Oh, no.
She was hiking. A guy's coming the other way. The trails, if you ever hike down in the river, are really narrow. It's fucking creepy, to be honest with you. Me and my brother did. It was awesome. But you understood when other people were coming, you're like, fuck this. I'm moving right against the wall. In some areas, it's like a wall or whatever, you get way away from the edge because you don't trust anybody else. So she moved out of the way to let this guy pass, tripped over her own feet, fell backwards into the canyon.
Holy shit.
Gosh.
And I believe she was one of the main people at Yelp.
Did anybody leave a review? Holy hell.
Let me see. Hold on. She was, can we hear?
Hiking, 35. She fell about 400 feet. Burns has worked for Yelp in a variety of positions. Since 2009, she was the company's Southeast Regional Marketing Director.
Oh, that stinks.
At the time of her death.
Can we go back? Can we scroll down a little? She was stepping out of the way. Oh, this guy was there.
Where? That? Or the video?
Oh, no.
Yeah, this is a...
That stinks.
That would just be terrible. That was one of the craziest things up on Denali. The first day we got to 14 camp, this guy fell down like 2,000 vertical feet of the space, and everybody at 14 watched it.
Oof.
Was he all right?
Felt to his death.
Now he's a travel marker.
Sprained his ankle or something. Did you see it?
No, luckily we saw them hiking, but we weren't up at 14 yet. But then when we got there the next day.
But everyone literally saw him fall.
Everybody literally just watched this guy roll down.
Oh,
2,000 vertical feet.
Right, it fell right into the fucking shit bucket.
Yeah, fell right in the shit crevasse.
Did everyone pick up their phones or what? Film that shit.
No, it was more just like kind of horror. Everybody, like, of course. You know, everybody. It was kind of, it's kind of one of those weird, like, I kind of wish that I did see it just because, but it's like, I don't know. It was so weird, but it also put our group in check. Like, as
you're thinking, this is very serious.
Yeah,
that was more serious than I realized.
It would suck to see that you pull your phone out, but you can't get the camera going because the gloves.
Let's hear the story of the Yelp lady,
Joshua.
This is an eyewitness, I think.
Our entire community is going to mourn her loss.
Colleen Burns was a connector, say her friends, spending her life bringing people together. Today, they came together without her to remember that life cut tragically short. Last week, Burns, a longtime Orlando resident and marketing director for Southeastern Cities at Yelp, took a trip to the Grand Canyon with two close friends. After a sunset tour Thursday night, they got up early Friday to hike, never guessing how one fateful photo would change all of their lives.
She was like stepping out of the way for another gentleman to kind of squeeze in, and unfortunately, Colleen just kind of got tripped up on her own feet and fell backwards. Fell into the canyon.
The Grand Canyon National Park Service says rangers found Burns' body 400 feet below. The National Park Service and medical examiner are investigating her death, but it is her life that her friends are honoring.
What do you mean investigating her death? What are they going to find?
Yeah.
Make sure she wasn't pushed.
Make sure.
Yeah, yeah. I guess. That stinks, though, because you know it's happening as you're falling. You can't fall backwards off a cliff and not know you're about to die.
When me and my brother went to the Grand Canyon at night, they had you could see the sun setting, and everyone goes to this one part. And people would just sit right on the edge with their feet dangling, and the drop-off was ridiculous. And you would get such anxiety. Me and my brother were sitting up against a tree about 20 feet away. We weren't even trusting that spot. And there were people like joking and laughing and leaning over, talking to their friends as their legs are dangling, as they're just sitting on the edge to check out the sunset. They wanted the best view possible, so that's where they sat.
Yep. Not going to lie, I've done that. Really? This place called Dead Horse Point in...
Oh,
Moab,
no, the poor ladies.
Area. And that's what we've sat on those cliffs, just dangling our feet, and it's just thousands of feet down. And people are like, are you kidding me? And you're like, it's fine.
No, I feel it in my gut. I'm like, I was like, please don't do that. I don't want to witness this. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Is there more to the story? Or is that about it?
I don't know. I didn't get a chance to preview it, but we really could play it.
The longest, strangest, craziest 2 seconds of my life. Those last 2 seconds where everything changed are so...
So they were getting ready...
minute in comparison to all the memories I have with her.
Friends say they will remember the 35-year-old for her genuine spirit, her love of Yelp, Orlando, her two Yorkies, and Cascade, the DJ she created a fan
group. And her horrible
Cascade
coordination.
I keep wanting to see the video, and I'm like, oh yeah, they don't just have cameras rolling.
I thought it was on a trail, but now it sounds like they were setting up for a picture, because they're now showing the picture.
No,
that picture was taken right before they went on the
trail. I guess that was probably the last picture taken, and then they went hiking.
Point, yeah.
Okay, I got it. Yeah, because I read it that they were getting out of the way,
and then did a Wile E. Coyote down the hill.
And these trails, some of these trails are no more than maybe 3 feet wide, and both sides you could fall to your death.
It's scary because, you know, when you're walking on like the subway platform, I always take the side of the track and just walk right by people. I'm always like, what if I just fell in?
Oh, God, no.
I never do that when there's a train coming.
I'll do it for that.
No. I stay away, man. I'm in the middle of the thing. I go where no crazy person could drag me.
Right.
Or push me.
That's the way to do it.
I always have my back on a wall or a pylon or something when I'm in the subway system. Fuck these people. I don't trust any of you.
Guys got some trust issues.
Well, we do, but we don't want to be dragged or pushed or whatever.
Pushed.
Not all of us could just wander around Central Park carefree. Collecting Pokemon. We live here.
Taking a big shit on the top of Kilimanjaro or whatever.
We live here. We know what these people are capable of doing. Can we do the Canadian tenor group before we get out of here? This is amazing. A guy decided to change the Canadian national anthem to make a... have you seen this yet? A political statement?
I didn't know they had a national anthem.
Oh, wow. Is this good? Yeah, play this for the guys and gal.
Canada,
I'll leverage this.
Our home and native land. True.
I like how it's an American flag on the side of that, not a Canadian.
Where?
It was on the last shot before.
We're all brothers and sisters. All lives matter to the grave.
What's the line supposed to be?
I haven't been to a hockey game in a while, so I'm not sure. But obviously, you change it to All Lives Matter.
Uh-huh.
Making this political statement, and boy, people were not happy with it.
Yeah. They should be annoyed at that. This
and
is stupid.
Travis was telling me before the show that the two guys weren't in on it. It was a lone wolf.
That one guy.
One guy said, I'm making my statement, and I'm not telling you guys I'm doing it.
Never
Damn.
Right? What's the actual line? With glowing hearts, we see the rise, the true north strong and free. All lives matter.
Fucking boo. Shut up.
Hey, play the rest of that.
Asshole.
At least make it funny.
It was at the All-Star game.
252 views. This is not doing well.
This version is hideous.
That's French.
That's how good. That part of it is always sung in French.
Why wouldn't it be?
They're probably from Quebec.
Quebecois.
Oh, please stop it. I'll back off.
God.
I don't like this song.
This is brutal.
As a national anthem.
No.
I love Canada, but I don't like this national anthem.
They got a good ending, though. They hammer it home.
Oh. Black Lives Matter!
What is this sign?
United We Stand. It's
okay.
Is that the same guy?
Yeah.
Same just guy. Gotta make it about himself.
Yep. Yep.
Gotta make it about him.
Yep.
What are you doing? Making it about me. Oh, say, can you see Jews by the doors?
What happened after that, Travis? Everything was cool with it?
Black guy beat him up, ironically enough.
Everyone was cool and let him... What? No?
Were they happy?
He got fired.
Did he?
Yeah, they kicked him out.
Good.
They kicked him out.
Fucking asshole changing the lyrics. You can't improv with the national anthem of your country. I'm sorry. You
can't do that.
Who fired... Or kicked him out of what?
The group is called the Tenors. They're popular.
You got my hopes up.
Oh, God. That's quick.
I was like, I liked them 5 years ago. Yes.
So they said that they didn't know what he was going to do, and now he's not in the group anymore. He said he got a little carried away with the whole, you know.
I understand the emotion of it.
So he decided to change his country's national anthem.
Hold up a sign when you're done, let's get along, whatever, that's great, but don't change the lyrics, you know? That's kind of stupid.
And I don't think Canada has the same problem with that as the United States, right?
No.
No, it was just because, you know, it was the All-Star game, and they had a national...
All lives matter!
Right.
Fucking shoehorning it.
You think he thought it was going to go over well?
He thought he was going to be on the news. Such a socially relevant and brave thing. I felt that it had to be said, all lives matter.
Fuck you.
It just felt better that way.
It just felt right.
You think he was just waiting for the praise to come in?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Where he would just be busy with a lot of praise in his interviews?
Good job. We didn't know you were going to do that.
Oh, my God. What was your inspiration for
brave.
This?
Brave.
Mm-hmm. What a hero.
He didn't plan on putting shit in the trunk of his car. Driving home,
putting that box with the plant in it.
Yeah,
in his car. Get the fuck out of here. Get your stuff and scram.
No life, man.
Now he's looking for tenor gigs on Craigslist,
and he'll never get one because they all know he. Well, he can't trust you to learn the lyrics.
Right,
you're the modern day version of MLK. My God.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. Did you study his teachings before you went out there and decided it was your turn to make a statement, make a stand? Let's go home now.
Wait, how much time we got left, E-Rock?
You're over.
Way to improv.
Nope. I panicked.
All right, Caitlin Farrington. Good seeing Caitlin Farrington, and really glad you puked in front of Paul Feig.
Good times.
Yeah.
Good times for everybody.
I'm glad I can always be here to entertain.
Oh, my God. That was really impressive, too. You don't fuck around.
No.
How many times did you puke? That was two or three blasts in here.
I know, and I might have to have another one.
Why would you
lose
the fingers down the throat? Because she didn't like the way I was telling her accurately that I take the two fingers.
I'm going to puke all over you if you keep talking about it.
Well, then you can tell this erection what it should do.
Let Jimmy get ready, at least.
Yeah, this Roman showers are not my thing. That's called a Roman shower. There's guys who literally like a woman to stand over them and then put their fingers in their throat and vomit into their mouths. Or vomit on their dicks. That's true. It's called
a
Roman.
If you accidentally...
Roman shower. Disgusting.
I would watch that as a goof, but I wouldn't watch it going, oh my God, this is such a turn on.
I've watched
it. Turned on by
be
that?
Like, this makes me so hard right now.
God.
No. You know what I hate about the vomit videos is they ruin my enjoyment of the shit that was happening right before. How do you spin that?
But if a girl pukes on your dick, it's kind of a compliment.
No, it's not.
It hits some back area.
Hey, I love your dick. That's a compliment.
All right.
Yeah. Why don't we play the other version that Paul Feig was talking about?
Because that's not been released yet.
Oh, okay. Yeah, we'll play...
That version comes out Friday with the soundtrack.
We'll play Walk the Moon, their version of the Ghostbusters theme, I guess. But before that, Caitlin, you're promoting anything.
Well, I'm actually going down to Argentina at the end of this month, and I'm going to... It's called SAS.
Ooh!
So it's a snowboard camp for, like, backcountry riding. And going to be a coach and a tail guide down there for the season. Which a
tail guide? Ooh, I could use one of those when I'm away. You know, at least some tail.
Sorry.
Just searching for that tail all the time.
Jimmy's vomiting jokes.
And how's the spine doing? We didn't even ask you.
I didn't know you were a spy.
Oh, sorry.
Any problems? Any
secret?
No problems.
Any new medical breakthroughs in that area?
No, still about the same.
Really?
Uh-huh.
I would imagine puking as hard as you did could also cause
it.
Oh my God!
Get the garbage can!
God!
Hold it in!
These guys,
let
don't think
out,
of the
sister.
Fingers down the throat.
I should puke.
Get her a bucket. Get her a bucket. God damn it.
Fingers down the throat. Don't think of that. Everyone was just watching her.
Oh, it's diarrhea,
it's
too.
Up.
Diarrhea, too.
You do. Stop drinking ginger ale. It's making you throw up.
Yeah, oh, my God.
It wasn't the Roman shower talk, was it? Where I was talking about people puking into each other's mouths? Holy crap.
Oh,
put your fingers
boy.
Down your throat. You tickle the back of that thumb. Get it out.
She was
get a photo. Get a photo.
She was booting into a mini water bottle until we got the garbage pail back in here.
She's a professional. That's a true alcoholic.
Oh,
that's
a fucking cum guzzling Nazi.
That was your breakfast at Starbucks.
Right. How you doing,
yeah.
Caitlin?
She's good.
Oh,
she's good. She's got her hands on her hips, looking all sassy.
Yeah.
Wow.
You need Jerry Sandusky behind you to get you in proper position.
Get rid of that. A little bit of bile. Get rid of that stomach bile.
Was that a condom that came out?
Yeah, choked you down last night.
Huh?
Oh, yeah, that was bad.
God.
Fingers down the throat. You want me to put a couple fingers? That helps me a lot. There you go.
All right. What a pro. Holy shit. I got the tingles from that.
Yeah, the pukes to turn on there.
You didn't get it on the rug?
You're drinking the wrong thing, by the way. The ginger ale is supposed to help you.
Right. Yeah.
For an upset stomach.
Well, yeah.
Spank.
Oh, your breakfast. I gave her the bag.
That's right.
Spank, bank,
wait,
check.
Wait, that was my breakfast?
I gave her the bag.
You couldn't take my breakfast out of the bag?
I didn't know there was something
in
there.
Oh, my.
I could grab her blueberry.
Oh,
God. It's still organic.
Yeah, you really
there's
did
a little,
puke.
Like,
oh,
puke
you're fine.
Them.
It's packaged.
Yeah.
It's
fine.
You're
yeah,
good.
Eat the blueberries.
You want me to open them up so it's just me touching my puke?
How's the oatmeal look?
Wow.
I'm debating this.
How can
I'm
you
debating
tell?
This.
Looks like puke already.
I'm debating this. Fuck.
Yeah, the thing is dripping.
Yeah.
My bad.
She puked on my fucking breakfast.
But
oh,
you're
you
not
going
to eat your blueberries.
You could have the please.
Have the blueberries.
You're not going to eat blueberries,
it's
though.
It's a superfood.
They're good for you.
Want some blueberries?
No, thank you.
I'm good.
Fucking no.
This Caitlin.
I can't wait to
animal.
See those coming up in an hour.
You're right.
Green and blue. You're vomiting all these delightful colors.
It's like Christmas.
A gold medal winner. This is the best.
I love it. Are you going out tonight?
Oh, there's a concert, actually, somebody had told me about. Maybe.
Who's playing?
Who is it? Let's see.
Are you Pokemoning later?
Are you Yeah, you know, you'll find me in the park.
Are you Pokemoning, making friends?
Making friends.
Hi, everybody. I just captured them and let them go.
Let them go.
Who is the people that are playing? Local natives?
I don't know.
I don't know either.
All right.
But I think they're local.
Sounds good.
Yes. Mark Norman, please. What do you got going on, buddy?
Well, you can catch me at the Syracuse Funny Bone all weekend. Then come out to next weekend to the Providence Comedy Connection. Then I'm in Montreal. Come on out to that. New Orleans, Joy Theater, and Portland, Oregon, Helium. And listen to my podcast, Tuesdays with Stories. And check out me on Twitter and
and all the rest.
All that good stuff.
Jim Norton.
Thursday the 21st, I'll be in Columbus at the Capitol Theater, and then Friday at the Gathering of the Juggalos. Coming up September 15th and 16th, I'm moving. Minneapolis and Pittsburgh have been moved. So the tickets you have will be honored on those dates. They're, instead of being in July, because I had to change a bunch of shit, we moved them to the fall, so I did not have to cancel them, which I did not want to cancel them.
Nice.
And then the Saturday, September 24th, I'm going to be in Ontario. And it looks like I'm going to go to Montreal, too. We're trying to find a venue, because there was a possibility of me doing something up there, which I did not want to do, so now we're trying to find something. And Australia, I may have in September.
Whoa.
Down Under.
I will know soon.
Very cool.
We should go to that.
Shrimps
on the Barbie. I don't know. I was saying
stuff. Foster's.
Oh, my God. Having a lager or something.
Very nice.
Playing some Pokemon.
Australian ship.
Pokemon.
What's that?
Australian ship.
Yeah.
You call that a knife?
Yeah. Fucking hopping around to something like a kangaroo. Well, whatever.
Caitlin, you ready to do your plug without puking? You were in the middle of a plug, weren't you?
Maybe.
Sassy snowboards.
Sassy. Yeah.
Having a Vegemite sandwich.
No, yeah, no. So Sass, it's just, what is it? South American snowboard camp. Earth. And yeah, they just, I'm just going down tail guide and go play.
Yeah.
Alrighty.
And then maybe climb volcanoes afterwards. I don't know.
Yeah.
I did that.
Is it podcast day? Tomorrow's podcast
Tomorrow.
Day. All right, we'll do that.
The podcast.
And we're good. We got some Tony Robbins videos if you want to check that out. We're trying to put videos up all the time.
All right.
He was fun. He had a good take on Black Lives Matter and why people hate on social media.
Oh.
A little insight on that. His appearance was a little different, but it was good. I liked it.
What does he think about alcoholism?
What is that hiding?
Mm-hmm.
You have fun today, Kaylin?
I had a great time, even though it puked multiple
times. That made it wonderful.
Good radio.
Awesome. That's what we're trying to do.
Yeah.
We're trying to get people just, you know,
yeah.
to get, we're trying to get Nadia Comaneci in here to shit blood.
You got to step it up next time you come in here. Miscarriage.
We're going to end the show and we're going to get that hanger. We're going to see what.
Whoa. All right. Yeah.
Wait, no. For what? Clothes?
Yeah.
Ruins everything. Fucking ruins everything. Play the Ghostbusters song. Oh, tomorrow, Daryl Strawberry.
Oh,
promoting
wow.
the 30 for 30, Daryl and Doc, or oh. Doc and Daryl. Daryl and Doc, I believe it's called.
Can we get a link to that, Roland?
Yeah, we got links.
I want to watch that.
Doc and Daryl. Thank you, Travis. So we got Daryl Strawberry tomorrow. Make sure you check that out. Have a good day. See you tomorrow. Here's Walk the Moon's version of Ghostbusters.
Who are you? Good. Oh.